some other people, and it's going to be fun. But anyway, we just got this together just to teach people how to act like Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus, he didn't even always, you know, pray. Sometimes his presence, you know, people just touch him. And that's kind of what we're going for. Peter walked on the streets, and they would lay the couches next to him with people, and they would get healed just by his shadow touching them. And so that's what we're just here for, is just, I mean, these are excellent teachers. I've listened to some awesome teachers of healing and whatnot, and this is the best that I found. Patty and Dave and Andy and some other people might come up. But anyway, we're going to be doing this, and just so people know too, I believe probably Mondays or Thursdays, we're just going to have a get-together, maybe every week, maybe twice a month, something like that, just to get together. If people need prayer, you need healing, you know, whatever it is, we'll pray. Might have, you know, a little word, like a Bible study. We don't call it a Bible study because we may not always study the Bible, but we'll have something just to feed you. Because I know a lot of times you get all fired up, and it's, you know, the conference, you know, pew sitters, and you conference to conference, and it's just like you're constantly wanting more, and you get fired up, and then you go back to maybe nothing at church. And I don't know where you guys are at, but, and so we're just going to do that, just kind of help fire you guys up, and keep you on the path of just operating like Jesus, because that's what we're here for. So anyway,
Amen.
Thank you, Dave and Patty and Andy and everyone who traveled up, a ways. It's going to be fun, and just take what you learn here and bring it to the streets.
Amen.
Not just here and go home and sit on it, but bring it to the people, because that's what, and again, that's what we're here for, is to share Jesus with the world. So
Amen.
God bless y'all.
Okay. I'm like, what are you looking to do?
I don't know.
Right now, in the name of Jesus, I command all pain, you go right now in the name of Jesus. Everything not of God, you go right now. Right now in the name of Jesus.
Tell us what's different. I didn't have to tell them what to do because I already knew what to do.
Yeah.
I knew they knew what to do.
Things are starting to loosen up, I think. I don't know exactly what happened, but I twisted my back at some point.
Guys, just
put
your hand
on
his back.
How about you? Sorry!
Just put your hand right there.
Right now, in the name of Jesus, all pain, you leave. You leave right now in the name of Jesus. You go!
Yeah.
Go right now in the name of Jesus.
Still there.
I said you leave right now in the name of Jesus.
That's Andy's dog.
Amen.
Get it to move, you can beat it.
I said you leave, not move in the name of Jesus. You go! Go right now in the name of Jesus. All affliction, you be healed right now in the name of Jesus.
Hey, you got a junior Holy Ghost, don't you?
Ooh. He's taunting you.
What did you tell us last year?
What did you tell us last year?
What?
What do you think? Is your Holy Ghost like the same one you did?
I do not.
You have the whole one, don't you?
Yes. It doesn't come in small portions for small people. It doesn't come in big portions for bigger people. You know, it just comes in the same size. You can be small and it can be like overwhelming you.
Amen.
You sure? G-shirt.
And just speak light and light right now in Jesus' name. I'll pay you. Go! In Jesus' name.
I get to share a testimony. I had her, we were doing this 2 years ago in Illinois, and she comes up, we're going to pray for a lady that never walked upstairs in her life. And she comes over and kind of bumps me and she says, can I do this? I said, well, yeah. It was kind of like this, and this lady was standing here, and she just said, in the name of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit, I speak life. And I had to catch the lady from going through the screen. So then her older sister, raise your hand, she says, can I do it too? So this poor lady got blasted again. And then mom, she blasts her, and this lady walked up the stairs first time. She was 70 years old, and she actually could walk up the stairs.
Normal.
It was cool getting it to work. But as I look around the room, the really neat thing is you can do what I can do, because you can do what Jesus can do.
Amen.
It ain't like it just because I've had a really weird life. It's because I know what's in me, and I know how to let that out. And I know how to teach you to get the same results. And these two, some of you heard the testimony. We all prayed, all the adults prayed for this lady that had no thumb. I just went down the line and blasted them. We kind of tag teamed the tougher ones. And Andy somewhere has got a video of this lady. These two here took a video of this lady's thumb growing back that night.
Yeah.
We didn't even know it until later. That's why I'm sharing that testimony.
Oh. Amen.
And if God did it one, he's no respecter of persons. He'll do it again. And when you start bragging on the testimonies, people think, all you do is bragging on you. No. I know better than anybody. It wasn't me that did it. But when I brag on the Holy Ghost, he says, hey, I want to do it again. I get you stirred up. The Holy Ghost says, I want to do it again. I want to do it again. I want to do it again. So I'm kind of unique in... I just want to brag on what God just used me, and I've done so many things wrong. If he can use me, he can use you. Now, how's your pain? Let the fire of God go through him right now.
For a second.
Grab a hand. You grab a hand. Just repeat after me. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
In the power of the Holy Spirit.
In the power of the Spirit.
And out of your belly, just go, life!
Life!
Now let go. We want to put it in and leave it. And then we add to it. So it's like a jack. Cha-ching, 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 cha-ching. We got it to move. So every time we're adding to it, we're not pulling our faith back. I was sharing with that lady earlier. A year and a half, 2 years ago, we were up in northern Minnesota. There was a totally blind lady. We blasted 12 times that she could read. What did we stop at 11? What did we stop at 2 or 3? But by doing this, releasing the kingdom over and over and over, she could read.
Are you in pain anymore?
Here, let me... Stop on your foot. You know what pain, like when you ask somebody in their pain, they go, yeah, I'm really in pain, and you blast them, but, well, I'm not sure. You know something's changed. We had one lady, and it will happen. What we're doing is taking a healing and pushing it into a miracle where it's instant. We'll get a couple testimonies before we get started. We went down to the homeless shelter in Des Moines. A week ago Tuesday?
A couple weeks ago.
2 weeks ago Tuesday. 50 people in a row got healed. And they didn't just get physically healed. We led them to the Lord. We got them set free. Patty's, almost everybody she prays for just gets filled with the Holy Ghost. So if you haven't got your prayer language yet, we'll get it. But the unique thing was, there was a guy that got shot. He still had the bullet in his leg. Must really hurt. Mm-hmm. I've never really been shot, but he was like, I said, your pain level 1 to 10, where is it? He says, it's 10. He couldn't even stand up. And we blasted him. It didn't work. It didn't work. It didn't work. But we kept quitting. And finally, I got my brother, Lord James. It seems like we get together. We just tag team it. We just got stirred up and blasted him. He says, it's a 9. 8. Pretty soon we got him to one, and we couldn't get it to totally go, so we got him, let's get up and walk. We had walked him around, and all of a sudden this guy got happy. I said, you're a minister. He said, no, I ain't. I said, you're a minister. God showed me you're a minister, and I know he's right. Well, I did go to Bible college. I used to be a pastor, and I kind of got in some trouble and got shot. But we didn't just get him physically healed. We got him out of what he was in, and he'd been embarrassed. And you know, God's always right, and how I know is God's always right, and I'm wrong, so I just let him tell me what things about people. It works better. You look smarter. People ask me questions, and if I just wait a little bit, he usually just drops it on me. So I'm not a theologian. I just knew who's the author is. And you know how I got most of this revelation? Most people will try to look through the written word, and that's a good place to start, but then they'll ask, what do you think? What do you think? I don't care what you think. I want to know what the author thought. I know I'm unique, but I want revelation knowledge. I might ask people, but how I get the answer is a little different. And sometimes it kind of looks like I'm complaining, because there's a revelation I need. I don't want to just answer. And I'd call Andy and others around, and sometimes it thinks like I'm really complaining, but I want revelation knowledge. And when they throw it back at me, the power of God would boom. Mm-hmm. That's it. Now I got the answer in that part of the gospel.
Amen.
And I worked with my brother James, and we did block work together. We both broke our backs at least once. And we throw blocks faster than anybody ever seen. It's like we're getting the presence of God, and you don't hurt no more.
You want me to stand up here?
I don't care.
Well, maybe you could tell them what you want them to do.
Well,
you guys can sit down
now.
Thank you. I like that.
I thought you might be getting uncomfortable.
Give him a hand. Yeah. I have no trouble bringing you into this. I'm an old cowboy truck driver, construction worker. I got hit by lightning twice in 1 month. I was dead for the fourth time. When I came back, almost everybody I've ever prayed for since has been. You don't have to get hit by lightning. You know, but it was a revelation to get back on earth that the book is always right. The written word stands above all other, but rightly divided. We've had some that wasn't rightly divided. We call them traditions of men. It's kind of like when you're cooking. You don't start with a dirty pile with a bunch of moldy stuff in it. Well, most ministries try to just add good stuff to a dirty pot. Mm-hmm. We come from the other side. We try to take, you already got Jesus in you. If you're born again, you've got Jesus. You don't have half of Jesus. You don't have a quarter of a Jesus. You either got Jesus or you don't. If you got filled with the Holy Ghost, you either got the whole thing or you don't. So we can't give you nothing. We're not going to impart nothing to you, except we're going to tell you what the Word of God says. What we do is we peel away everything that isn't Christ. Any traditions. It's kind of like a sculpture. We chip away the things that are holding you back. Mm-hmm. But it seems like you get more of God because there's less of you getting in the way. That's why a lot of these other ministries go, because you get all stirred up and you think God got bigger. You already got more than you can ever imagine living in you. The problem we have is not knowing how to let Jesus out. Because the Spirit, your Spirit, the Holy Spirit, has to come through your brain. Your brain is like a filter. So as we pull the dirt out of your filter, Jesus comes out without restriction. It's not an anointing. It's not a special gift. If it's a special gift, I couldn't get you to do it. Sorry. If it was a special anything, I couldn't give it to you, because only God can give it to you. But we can get anybody to heal the sick because we teach you what a Son of God does. A Son of God, if you needed a prophetic word, you could give it. If you needed a word of knowledge. Like if she was dying of cancer, I said, well, you know, I only have a prophetic gift. You're just going to die. Would that help her? No. And you've heard some of this stuff going around. She needs a miracle. She don't need a word about a miracle. She needs the miracle. And then after she's healed, you can prophesy all you want to. Let's get back to what the book said to do. What did he tell the first 12 to go do? heal the sick, raise the dead, and cast out devils. What do you tell the next time you do? Heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. What do you tell all believers to do? Heal the sick, raise the dead, and cast out devils. Now, just hitting an overview, you're going to have some lot better teachers than me come up. They're more better speakers. But I got the basics. Healed in the Bible was a package deal. It was everything in the atonement. It was a free gift. And we've had so many people try to manipulate God to give you something he's already given you. I do this little, I'll pick on you again. The Bible says that you've gotten everything. You've got every good thing God has said, every good thing about you, every blessing, every switch in heaven has already switched in your favor. And he gives you the keys. Ask me for that key. You already got it, son. Ask me another 10,000 times. God, please heal me, please. You know, all he can say is I already did 2,000 years ago.
Amen.
So what we do is we're going to teach you to quit asking God to give you what's already in your hand, how to use what you've already got. Now, if I told you that you could have my car and all you do is put this ignition, would you ask me 10,000 more times for that key? You'd put it in the car and drive away. That's the difference, what we do. Instead of shooting at heaven, we start shooting at the enemy. Mm-hmm. We take God at his word. That's faith. Mm-hmm. No, it says right here, this is what believers are going to do. They're going to lay hands on the sick. They're going to command. We're going to speak to them mountains and they will move. And that's what David did. He was the only one that spoke to the giant and told him how big God was. The rest of the country was telling the God how big the giant was. I had this as a kid. I thought, you know how backwards? I was getting in trouble in second, third, fourth grade in Sunday school because it says right here, David could do it, and we could do that. You know, that's old covenant. We live under a better covenant. Do you see the difference? I think different. I was abused as a kid. I died when I was, before I was really two, probably. I can remember going to heaven and coming back. I remember laying hands on animals and coming back from the dead. My mother couldn't have babies, and I got a sister that's 5 years younger than me, so I had to be four. I was already prophesied. I didn't know what it was. I just tell people what I see, and they didn't always like what I told them. And I didn't speak most of my life because I got tired of being put down at a young age. I got hurt in church. I didn't want to go to church no more. I'd read my book, and the church would tell me it's the opposite of what the book said. You see the different mindset I have? I'll share a couple other testimonies just so you know. I never wanted to be in the ministry. All I seen was hypocrites. I'd already been dead and been back from the dead. And I got beat one too many times. I was 13 years old. My dad was going to beat me to death for not telling a lie. I told him my father was in heaven and he just won't finish it. And he froze. And I went to my teachers and my family, and nobody listened. They looked like good little church people when they were in town. So I made a pipe bomb. I was 13 years old, and that bomb went through my eyes, through my face. I floated out of my body for the second time. I came back, and I didn't want to be here. Nobody wanted me. And then they took me to the best eye doctor in the world, so I'd never see, picked parts out of both eyes. And I had it was so real to me. It was like Jesus walked into my room and I walked out with new eyes. I read the bottom of the eye chart to him. When I was 22, I was driving a cab over a Freightliner. And there was like one sheet of aluminum between you and the crash. And I came over the hill on ice and the ditches were full, made national news. I had a choice of killing some people or hitting the park semi. Hit the park semi, floated out of my body for the third time. They took me to the hospital, a mangled mess, and before morning I walked out. Then about 12 years ago, I got hit by lightning twice in 1 month. Fried two semis. The guy didn't want me driving his truck. It's funny now, but when you were there, it was not funny. Like, what is going on? I'll tell you, I lost millions in a divorce that took 3.5 years. My town didn't want me. My family didn't want me. And I drove into Fort Dodge, Iowa, in an old rusty out Dakota pickup that I gave $500 for that probably wasn't worth that. And an audible voice says, "Go to Goodwill." Like, what is going on now? And it was like I was energized, like that electricity. If you ever got hit with the power of God, it just, I don't know how else to describe it. It's like you're getting electrified. I don't know where, I've never been to this town, let alone know where Goodwill is. And I turned and looked Goodwill there. So I went to the Ford dealer, walked into the, what am I going to do here? And the lesson in this, I was obedient. I had no clue what I was going to do. But I went to the book section, and off to the side, there was four books. And I swear my name was on them in big, bold print. And I'm starting to vibrate. And I'm starting to ball. Now, cowboys don't do that in public. And I'm starting to, nose is running, you know, trying to look. And I'm getting shaken now. First book was I Believe in Miracles by Catherine Kuhlman. I had no clue who she was. Next book was The Anointing of Benny Hinn. I didn't have a clue who he was. I knew I read about the anointing. I just didn't understand it. Third book was Catherine Marshall, The Helper. And there was a book, You Can Ask Him Anything. And I walked out of Goodwill with four books and a Bible for $2. That's about all I had. And I shook night after night reading them. It was kind of like Benny Hinn's Good Morning, Holy Spirit. I shook and shook, and somebody asked me to go to church on Sunday. I didn't want to go to church again and get beat up, but I couldn't say no. And I walked in, and some total stranger, same thing, you know, I hadn't been to town, says, "God told me to give you this." Like, are you crazy? That's what I wanted to say. And I opened it up to chapter one. I read two paragraphs, and a lady that far away started, "What are you doing to me?" I said, "I ain't doing nothing." But I know who is. I was smart enough to know it wasn't me. Carpal tunnel arthritis lab. First church to kick me out for healing the sick. You gave me the book. You gave me the book and told me that was from God. All I did was read it and didn't compute. So I wasn't wanted. So I helped out at treatment centers and halfway houses. And I'd just say a simple prayer. You're going to not. The one, two is going to change. Everything's going to change in your life. And they'd come back mad. I spent my whole paycheck and I couldn't even get a high. Really? It's working that good. I'd give them rides because I traded my old pickup for an old $300 minivan. So you know what it looked like. Then you could put more people in it. And they wanted to go to AA and NA meetings, and I'd get them going down the road, and I'd preach to them. They couldn't get out right away. They were afraid to jump, I guess. And they were getting born again. They were getting saved, and they were just getting delivered. And then I got in trouble from the leaders because I was getting more results than all the counselors. I thought it was a good thing. And then 5.5 years ago, I met my wife, Patty. I had something I couldn't beat. I knew I never had to be sick again. And I lived an hour and a half from Des Moines, and there was a prophet. And the first time I met this prophet, he's a bodybuilding guy. His name's Tom Stamm, and never met the guy before. And he touched me, and he bounced. He says, "You've been dead more than once." I never told nobody that. In the next 2 weeks, I met three more prophets. I never met a prophet in my life, and I meet three in a week now. And they all knew that I'd been dead more than once. And they start pulling me up in front of crowds. And I don't like getting in front of crowds. Okay, God, I might as well just tell them because they're going to make me do it anyway. So I got a cold I can't get rid of. And I was wrong, but it was a way of God getting me to see the prophet again. And I walked in the door, and as soon as I did, the snot just left. I can go home, you know. I don't even have to wait for the meeting. I had to get up early, and her friend asked me if I wanted to go out to eat, and I didn't. And I couldn't say no. Because I had to get up at 5 o'clock and go back to work at the factory, and I had an hour and a half drive, and it was 10 o'clock. I didn't want to stay up all night. So they asked me to go to Perkins. And?
Which part?
I met you at Perkins.
Yeah.
Well, we talked, and gave us revelation, and he prayed for me. And when he prayed for me, it was like butter was just melting down over me. And I'd had a lot of people pray for me before, and he didn't even lay his hand on me. And I never felt that before. And so I just knew that he was the man that I was supposed to marry. I asked God to bring him to me because I thought, I'm ready. I know what I want. Yeah, I wasn't ready for you, honey.
I did it before the fall.
Thanks, Andy. So, it's like, I knew. Although, I'd been married and divorced 3 times, so I did have to ask God again. And it's like, God, I really, really want to know, is this really the one you want me to marry? And he showed me a vision of Dave and I up on a stage with people, and you can't see the end of them. There's so many people. And that we'd be ministering and having a healing ministry. And I'm just like, God, I just asked you if I was supposed to marry him. But that was his answer, because it wasn't just a yes or no. This is what you're going to do if you get married. So we just started having, we dated for 2 months and we got married. And we got married at Tom Stammen's opening of his prayer cabin. And we just started having home meetings, and it just grew and grew. We wanted to have a healing room, and so we got hooked up with John G. Lake Ministry. We went to a couple of his divine healing technician training seminars with Curry Blake, and went to the annual conference. So we met Andy at the first annual conference we went to, and then he came to our house. We did a DHT, and so we've known for a couple years now, 2.5.
Okay.
So we just grabbed a hold of this message and just ran with it. We were already praying for people and they were already getting healed, but we didn't have the message to teach it. And so this is, you know, the message that we learned to help other people get it. Because we could demonstrate people were praying for people and they were getting healed, but there was more of a teaching that we were missing. So that's why we've been doing that. And it's just been such a blessing, you know, that we've got people trained up all over that are doing this. And it's helping us to have more confidence because we have the answers, you know. And there's so many people that were taught in different religious settings, and they have different sacred cows that I don't think that people meant to learn things wrong. You know, it's just what they were taught, and it wasn't a truth. It wasn't from the Bible. And so we want to break some of those things off so people can get healed, because, you know, we want to see people healed, and we want to train people up to walk in this. And, you know, it's just such a blessing meeting Andy and his family and Kurt and their family, because they all get it. They're all walking in it. And, you know, it's just really amazing to see a whole family that's doing this. And it's not hard. It's really not. And the most important thing is just going out and doing it. Mm-hmm. You know, once you're done with the training this weekend, we don't want you to just go back to church and sit in the pews. We want you to go out in the public, and we want you to pray for people. We want people to be healed. We want you guys to step out and do this. You know, the word is the Great Commission, to go get people healed, get them set free, just bring them back from the dead if need be. And we've done that. We prayed for people, and they came back from the dead. And it wasn't that we were looking for it. It just happened in front of us. And, you know, do you guys have the faith to bring somebody back from the dead? It's not you. It's just when you lay hands on them and you let Jesus out. Mm-hmm. Whether it's a healing or whether they died. And, you know, you just speak life into them. and you will see what a difference it makes. You know, one of the hardest ones for me was my family. And I just recently just really got tired of Satan beating me in that area. You know, it's like we walk in divine health, thank God. And other things are coming around and getting better. But my mom, she's 76 years old, and she's really sick. And February 6th, we went to her place, and my kids and my grandson. And she just really didn't look good. She was in awful pain. She had a pain pump and a pain patch. And she just didn't really receive prayers when I would pray for her. And I finally thought, you know what? I don't care if she wants it. She doesn't realize what she's saying no to. And so I just continued to pray for her in person and not in person. And so February 6th, she had pain patches and pain pumps. And like a week later, I went back and she said she wasn't using either one of them anymore. Mm-hmm. And that's a miracle. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, Mom, I said, God did this for you. I've been praying for you. I expect you to be healed. You know, that's what we do all over. And she just, it's like all of a sudden it clicked in her head. And she's like, well, I have a new doctor. And it's like, Mom, the doctor can't take your pain away from you. And so she just really getting a hold of it. And so I'm like, Mom, I want all your pain to be gone. I want you healed of everything. And so she's like, well, pray for this. And my mom would never let me do that before. The first time she met Dave, he prayed for her knee, and she said, I just can't receive that. And it was just like, oh. Well, I just got fed up. And it's like, you're going to get healed. You're going to get healed in Jesus' name. And she had pain so bad when she'd stand up in the morning, it would just like shoot from here down that she would have to just stand still because it was so horrific. She couldn't even move for about 90 seconds. She had a walker and she had a bulging disc back here and she had surgery set. And I just talked to her today and she goes, I don't think I'm going to have the surgery anymore. Mm-hmm. And the pain when she gets up is gone. And it's just like, oh, thank you, Jesus. Every time I talk to her on the phone, there's something new and better that God's doing in her. And she had a stroke and she had like 30% of her vision blacked out that she couldn't see. And she said, it's only about 10% now. And I'm just like, oh, yes. And she's feeling so good. She actually said tonight on the phone, I got the okay from my doctor, and I think I'm going to go down to Florida and take a vacation for 10 days. And it's just like, yes. You know, to live life to its fullest. Because when I saw my mom a couple weeks ago, she just really didn't look good. I have to admit, I saw death on her. And that's when I really went after. It's like, no, Satan, you're not taking out my mom. I'm not letting you. I'm not backing down. You pushed me far enough. You're done. You're not doing this. And so sometimes it just takes till you get fed up and you've had enough, whether it's yourself or a family member, and you just go after it. And you know what? You see a big, big difference. I bet you guys have family or friends that you know that aren't doing too good. And you know, we just want you to know that you can lay hands on them and you can see them heal. That it's just amazing. We want you to really know who you are in Christ. That you have the capability. If you have Jesus in you, you have that capability. It doesn't take any special person or any special anointing, like Dave said. You just let Jesus out. I think the thing that people just don't get is that it's being surrendered. When you finally let God out of the box, you let God do what he wants to do instead of what Patty wants to do, you know, there's times when I've gotten in the way. No, Dave, we're already recording it. But, you know, you can just see mighty things happen. And it's so amazing, all the different things that God has done in our lives. Our house was in foreclosure 2 years ago, and we just kept declaring, we're doing the work of the Lord. We're not going to lose our house. We are just walking in divine health. We're doing what God wants us to do. He is going to save our house. And you know what he did? $36,000. 2 weeks before the sale. And you know what? It just spoke volumes to our family and our friends. Some people were well-meaning and said, well, you know, you can move in with us, or you can put your boxes in our home, and, you know, we'll help you. And I just kept saying, no, we're not going to lose our home. No. We are going to do the work of the Lord, and we are going to stay in our home. And it's going to be a testimony for the Lord. And, you know, it wasn't always easy. It wasn't at all. But I just kept declaring it, and I believed it. And God came through. And so I want you guys to wrap your minds around this, because there's so much that we're not walking in, that we haven't grabbed all that God wants us to have. You know, the story about King David, when he was a child, he was anointed. But he didn't walk in it yet. And he grew in favor and strength, and a mighty warrior. And King Saul got jealous. You know, he married his daughter, and then he went after him to kill him. And David ran and hid in the caves. And he finally got fed up, just like I did with my mom. And he went after King Saul, he cut his robe, got the knife, and he had the favor of the Lord, or he would have never been able to get in among all of them and take that. And so Saul realized he had favor. But King David didn't have to do that. He already had the favor of the Lord. And so I want you guys to grab hold of that, because there's things that you can do too, that you can declare about your family, your friends, your finances, whatever situation it is. We're not walking in. Somebody told us, you know, even though we had miracle service, they saw what we did. They said, you're not even walking in a tenth of what God wants you to. And it's like, wow, there's just so much more. And as believers, we want you to grab that, because it's possible for everybody. You know, just when we go out and about, wherever we're at, we just lay hands on the sick wherever we are. You know, when we go to the restaurant, we pray for a waitress. I was just in Dollar Tree a few weeks ago, and the lady behind the counter was coughing and blowing her nose. You could tell she had a cold. And I said, how are you doing? I'm not doing too good. And I just put my hand over the counter and I said, let me pray for you. And she did. You know, when it just takes that holy boldness to come out of you. And that's when Patty has to get out of the way, that I can't be thinking, what if she tells me no? What if she gets mad at me? What if I hold up the line? Who cares? Let Jesus out. Let Jesus touch that person and watch him be healed. Because it happens over and over and again. And we want you guys to grab that. Because it's really that simple. When you get out of the way. You know, there's times when I don't even think about it. It's like the compassion that Jesus had just comes out of me. And it's like, there's times I'll run after people when I see what's wrong with them. I always pray for pregnant women, because God showed me, you know, they don't have to have pain in labor. And that's how it started. So I go up to him and I just say, hey, I'm a minister of the Lord. And you don't have to be ordained. You're all ministers, everybody here. Mm-hmm. And I just say, I pray for pregnant women and they didn't have to go through labor pain. Can I pray for you? And you know, I've only had a very few people that have said no, very few. And so I just put my hand out and they give me their hand and I pray for them and I bless them and their child and I pray for their child to be healthy and whole for the rest of their pregnancy, to be a good pregnancy. And you know what? The Holy Spirit knows when I'm praying for them because it's my intent that that mom and that baby get filled with the Holy Spirit too. And one time I was thinking about this and it was just like, Lord, you know, it's in the future, everybody that I pray for. But then he also showed me, you know, we can't keep it tiny. Everybody that I prayed for in the past, that they be healthy and whole too. Because there's no time or distance with the Lord.
Amen.
So we just have to think outside of the box or just listen outside of the box. You know, God's talking to us if we're just listening. And then he also told me that there's pregnant women that when I pray for them, there's something wrong with those babies and their tummy. And then I pray for them and they can be born healthy and whole. So one time I went to the grocery store with my daughter and I saw a pregnant lady and I said, Kenzie, just keep going. She knows what I'm doing. So I go pray for him. And there's another pregnant lady that walks right by me and I'm thinking, no, Lord, let me find him when I get done with this, you know? And so I finish with that one and then I do. I go find the other one and she goes, you hunt him down, don't you, Mom? Well, when I have to, yeah, I sure do. Because I want that baby to be born healthy.
Amen.
And if there's something wrong with it, you don't know.
Right.
And so there's just, if you're just listening, God's talking to everybody. And he's given us different ideas. Things that we can do to help people. There's just so much more. You know, we've been transported when we've driven. I think the most that I know of when we were driving together was like 45 minutes ahead of time. And, you know, that's pretty cool. When you get somewhere faster and you don't have to use as much gas, take as much time. But we know that it's bigger than that, that God can do more than that.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's just another example. And it might sound a little weird, but you know, if Jesus can do it, so can we.
Amen.
So let's not put God in a box. Let's just let him do what he wants to do. And you know, with the weather, I don't know what I did wrong, but I was declaring over this stuff. I didn't order this stuff. I told it to go. But anyhow, there's times when we have seen it literally stop right then and there. Because we do really have the authority to do that, just as Jesus did. And so, why not do it? You know, we want people to come to this meeting tonight. We don't want anybody getting in an accident. And we just want to see more people getting what God has for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, it really is. And you know, one time I had a lesson. I was driving home with my daughter in the car and it started snowing and I declared it stopped. And within a couple minutes it did. About 10 minutes later it started snowing again. I'm like, hey, no, I told you no. And so within a couple minutes it stopped. And then it started about 10 minutes later. I'm like, okay, the rest of the way home.
Yeah.
You know, our words frame our world.
Amen.
We have to say what really needs to be done. And it was a lesson. And I said, I want the sun to come out. I want the roads to be dry. I don't want to drive in this. And you know, it was really cool because my daughter got to see it happen too. And then the sun came out and it was dry the rest of the way home. And that was really neat. We do have the authority.
Amen.
We just need to know who we really are. And so I want Ben. Oh, Ben, he used to wear glasses, didn't you, Ben? You want to come up here? We were, where were we? We were in Wisconsin somewhere. Were we, Madison? Is that where it was? And I used to wear reading glasses, and I don't have to anymore. I'm 53, and thank God I don't have to anymore. I did wear them for 6 years until I realized I really don't have to. And I was given that testimony, and I said, you know, anybody that doesn't want to wear them anymore, and what happened? What happened with you?
I was just, my dad and me were driving. Then I took off my glasses to see if I could read the signs. And then I told my dad, what the signs said.
And now you don't wear them anymore, do you? Thank God.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. And I don't think anybody even prayed for you that night, did they? We had all the kids, we had them come up and praying for people. And he came up to get prayed for, but there was so much commotion on. We were having the kids pray for him that we didn't realize that he wanted something because we had the kids all praying for the adults. But you got healed anyhow, didn't you?
Tell him what happened when I had you pray for that great big guy.
I prayed for him, then he fell.
Biggest Amen. Guy in the room, and he's kind of a timid guy like I used to be. I said, watch this, I'm going to have one of my Holy Ghost kids come up there. And he was a minister. I don't know if you knew that. He was just a little off in his doctorate. So I watched this. He's going to pray for you, and the power of God's going to hit you. And they go like, rrr, rrr, rrr. Bam!
Oh.
You did it two or three times, didn't you?
Yeah.
It's so cool when the kids get to do it, you know? And we've had them come up in California and when we're in Madison, different times, and the kids do it, and, you know, everybody knows that, wow, this is for real. God's using these kids. They don't have to think, who are you up there, you know? They see that the kids are doing it, and it's like, wow, this is neat. Well, Andy, why don't you come up? Whatever the Lord puts on your heart, we know it's got to be good. Right?
Amen. Always good. Yeah. So, I'm glad everybody can make out tonight. It's crazy weather coming up about Appleton way. It's always good to minister with Dave and Patty. It's been probably about 6 months since we've had an opportunity to minister together. There was a streak there where we ministered together so much, I could get up here and say, let me tell you Dave's testimony. He's been dead 4 times, gone to heaven, had his back broke twice, his neck broke twice, his eyes blown out of his sockets twice, never spent more than a night in a hospital, never had a stitch in his entire life. Pretty good, huh? I can still do it. It's been about 6 months. So, it's good. But I want to let you know, in case you haven't died 4 times and had your eyes blown out of your head twice and that kind of stuff, that if you're a Christian, you've died all the times that you need to die to be able to for God to use you supernaturally.
Amen. Amen.
My Bible says that I was crucified with Christ 2,000 years ago.
Amen.
So I'm as dead as I need to be. As far as God's concerned, we've all died and we've gone to heaven. And now we're seated with Christ in heavenly places. And now we're living out the remainder of our life in this body, not by our power, but by the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Amen. That his spirit lives inside of us. He's made us after his own image and his likeness. Amen. And now he's put into us the very life of the Son. He's adopted us as sons. And Amen. So that's the message that we carry. And so we're gonna do a lot of stuff this weekend. You know, we have a lot of testimonies that we can share, and when we share those, I hope you understand we're sharing those because we want you to have a vision for what God can do through you. We're not doing that to lift ourselves up or anything. In fact, some of the favorite testimonies that we share these days, or what God's done through other people. You know, recently I just came back from Cambodia, and I spent 3.5 weeks there. And one of the things that I was doing was helping a missionary, right? So this is not a novice Christian. He had been there for 12 years in Cambodia, and he was doing his best to reach these unreached peoples. And the most success he was having was there were a couple of people that were younger that actually needed a place to stay. They'd come stay in his house. He'd teach them English. They would see his family life, and because he had his family in order, you know, he's following Jesus. And they would realize, man, what is going on? And they would realize God is real, Jesus Christ. They'd start learning more, and they'd say, man, this is what I want. And they'd come to know Christ, and he'd begin to help them become disciples to the degree that he was a disciple. You know, he's following Jesus. But it's interesting. Didn't Jesus say that when a disciple is fully trained, he will be just like his master?
Amen.
You know, and so sometimes we have this mindset that discipleship is growing in character and understanding of the word. But Jesus said, no, it's about following me and becoming just like me. That's Jesus's vision of discipleship.
Right.
And so one of the, you know, Jesus said, go make disciples, teach them to obey everything I commanded you. One of the, you know, that turn the other cheek stuff, that's real fun. The, you know, don't look on a woman, lust after, you know, that's, you know, all that stuff. God's purifying our hearts so that we become people that live out of his supernatural love. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But those are kind of hard sometimes. But there's some really fun ones in there. Go preach the kingdom, heal the sick, cast out demons, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers. And, you know, we got to those in my discipleship, my early discipleship. When I came to know Christ in college, and so I became part of a discipleship-oriented college group. And, you know, then we would study the books of the Bible. You know, we'd get into Matthew, and I remember, like, what do we do about these? And I was looking around for examples. How many of you, like, you know, you're just these wide-eyed Christians. You just put your faith in Jesus Christ, and you read all these verses, and you're like, where are the examples? You know, like, where are the people that are doing this? And then when you go to the people that are around you that are more mature, that you begin to respect, and you begin to hear them give their explanation. Oh, that was only for the apostles. Or, oh, that was for back then before we had the Bible. Or, oh, and you hear all these explanations from people around you, but you keep looking in the book for those explanations, and they ain't there. And then you begin to say, somebody's wrong. And you do this little Martin Luther thing and say, you know what? I've got some thesis I'm going to tap up here. I think that we ought to be doing the same stuff too. And that God's not really going to be upset at us if we begin to take him at his word and say, okay, you know, I'm not presuming to be a superstar. I'm just presuming to be a believer.
Amen.
Is that okay?
Amen.
And I think, you know, and so then you begin to take some steps out. And that's what I did. Began to take some steps out. And I began to find, lo and behold, it works. So, you know, I like what Dave was saying earlier. We do not do impartation. When you receive Jesus, when you receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit, you receive what you need. So what we do is extraction. We take stuff out of you that got put in you that is hindering the flow of the Holy Spirit from your life. Okay, so that's what this weekend is going to be about. And we'll do it with the word. We'll do it with testimony. We'll help get you activated in this. So if you're you know, saying, where's all the Bible verses and all that kind of stuff, don't sweat. We got some time together. So part of tonight, we're just kind of laying a little bit of groundwork and that kind of thing. Let me just share a few testimonies of why, what some of the stuff is going on. One of the things that's neat is that as we've walked into this, as a family. So as I started to learn this, you know, around the dinner table, I'd start to share, hey, Do you know what? God will still heal. Well, how? Well, it's just real simple. Jesus said believers will lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. So we lay hands, and he also said that, you know, that what you speak to the mountains and they'll move. So if things don't line up with the kingdom, you just, with your heart, you know, receiving from God, you release that through your word. You know, and first thing happened, my little Phoebe, she got up, you know, out of her chair, she put her hand on my head and said, Jesus' name, hair grow! Right on Daddy's head, you know? And lo and behold, came shooting out my face. So, next time, you know, and I got this weird stuff going on my ears and the shoulder, you know, it's weird now. So, we got to be more specific next time. We're learning that. So, But now, you know, it's really cool because whenever my wife goes out doing grocery shopping or my kids go out with our family anywhere, you never know who's going to come back. Like, they come bursting through the door. Dad, somebody got healed. You know, and they're all excited. Wow. You know, so every trip to Walmart, every trip to the gas station, every trip to McDonald's, every trip to the grocery store is a mission trip.
Amen.
We're always on mission. And so whenever is amazing, you know, Patty said, you know, there's one pregnant lady, she's praying for you to tell the daughter to go on. Then she's another one. You know, it's amazing. When your eyes get open to this stuff, you begin to wonder, man, it's just everybody pregnant. Yeah. You know, or it's like, you know, for me, I see people with walkers and oxygen tanks and riding in the motor scooter, shopping carts and stuff like that. And it's amazing that when your eyes are open and you begin to believe in what Jesus Christ can do through you, wow, it's like your whole world becomes open. And where you were beginning to pray all this time, you know, Lord, please open a door. How can I ever reach anybody around me? You begin to see, wait a second, the possibilities are endless. There's always people. And even people, you know, we realize now that a lot of people are carrying conditions around in their body that you can't see. So almost any conversation that you get in, you can just simply say, you know, this might sound like a strange question, but do you have anything that's given you problems or pain in your body? And they'll say, that is kind of strange. And you just wait for a second. But, you know, then they'll go on, da da ba 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 ba, and they'll start talking to you about all their pain. Because you know what? People who are in pain, they like to talk about it. People who've got problems, they love to talk about their problems. And they really are excited when there's somebody who's asking them. And then they'll say, yeah, I got this. Why do you ask? You know, the reason I ask is because I've seen God do some amazing things, and I know Jesus Christ wants you well. Give me your hand, honey, real quick. Or give me your hand just for a second. And they'll say, what? You know, they don't really have, they're not quite sure what's going on. And they'll say, well, I don't believe any of that. Say, don't worry, this is going to be great. I do. You know, and that's where it gets to be a lot of freedom, because a lot of times you have been told from the pulpit on the basis of the fact that God does work healing through faith, that you've been told that if you don't get healed, it's because you don't have enough faith. And so every time, if you believe that, when you go to and see someone who's got a condition, well, you don't know whether they believe or not. So you just got, well, there's a whole nother layer of hesitancy. So I just want to let you know, it's really cool. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 through 18, it says, Jesus said that believers will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So who you got in there? You got believers and you got the sick. So the sick don't have to be the believers.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
That's really good. It's nice to know that I can do the believing for you.
Amen.
You know, or they may say, you know, oh, I don't believe that at all. And they'll say, okay, but I do. And all you've got to lose is your pain. Hold still. Right? So It was really cool. This missionary buddy of mine that I had met. This is a neat testimony. I just maybe want to share a little bit of this story because it means a lot to me. Because my wife and I, and Simeon and Noel were there too, we were in Turkey for 2 years. This was way back in 98 and 2000. We were there for 2 years. And at that time, I was a theological charismatic, meaning I had no experience of the Holy Spirit, but I believed it. I believed it was there. I was just like, come on, God, show me how this works. Okay? That's where I was at that time. And we were getting our butts kicked out on the mission field. So that's why I want to tell you there's a difference between believing that it's real and having it operating in you through faith.
Amen.
You know, somebody can believe that Jesus died and rose again and not be saved.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
You can believe that the Holy Spirit's been poured out and it not be operating in your life. There's so many churches that we talk to about, you know, trying to do our seminars and stuff like that. And the pastor say, oh, we believe in healing. And then we'll ask the next question, do you have sick people in your church? And they'll say, oh, yeah, lots of sick people. Do you have lots of people that are healing the sick and lots of testimonies every week? Oh, no, no. I remember when I went to Cambodia, it was really interesting, you know, we had a dinner one time with some missionary friends, and I was just sharing a little bit about some of the stuff God's been doing and what I believed. And one of the missionaries next to me, you know, he's, oh, yeah, I believe that. Oh, yeah, we believe that. Yeah, that's what we teach. And then I was thinking, man, this guy gets it. And then he said, yeah, last year our church had 12 confirmed healings. And this is, you know, I had been there for 3 days. And we had 12 confirmed healings yesterday. And so I'm like, oh, gosh, you know, you don't get it. Because if you do get it, you realize, man, there's no sickness, no disease, no demon that has a chance against what you're carrying inside of you.
Amen.
And so you become aggressive because you know that the kingdom of heaven is advancing and the gates of hell cannot stand Amen. Against it.
Right.
It's not that we're on the defense. It's that the church has been sort of, you know, hypnotized into believing that coming and attending Sunday morning worship and getting a nice spiritual smooge on and being decent moral people and listening to Christian music.
Oh man.
Sorry. Is sort of the epitome of the Christian life, not so much as it's taught from a pulpit, but as it's lived, the DNA of the church culture. And it makes me want to cry. It makes me want to vomit. It makes me want to scream. It makes me want to say, no, no, no. Do you know that inside that little clay pot that's sitting in your chair is glory?
Amen.
Do you know that the gospel that Paul preached is Christ in you, the hope of good church attendance and tithing? No, that Christ is in you, the hope of
glory.
Yeah. Do you know that God wants to be glorious through you? We are so used to reading this book and seeing the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ and saying, man, he's awesome, he's awesome. And then we have an opportunity to let Jesus be awesome through us. And we go, oh, well, that's Jesus stuff. You know, that's not Jesus's mindset. And so those things that are in our minds and in our hearts that say, that's a Jesus thing and I do me differently, I'm striving to attain to that. Can we just say, that's the crap that we need to get extracted. That's the stuff clogging up the filters. That's the stuff that needs to be renewed to the Word of God. Because who is the Word of God?
Jesus.
That's right. So if your mind and your heart are renewed to this, that now you got all the channels open, all the plugs in, all the tubes clean, so everything matches. This word and the word of God who lives in you, because Jesus, we are his body.
Amen.
And he is still the word made flesh. Amen. Now he's just manifesting himself in our flesh. He's making us the word made flesh. So it's not about what you know and what you agree with. Do you understand? There is a difference between, oh, I agree with that. Oh, I agree with that. No. Is it a living, or is it in you? Is the word, is that word something that is made flesh in your life?
Right.
You understand? That's what the Holy Spirit has come to do, is to make Jesus, we are the reincarnation of Jesus. Some people say, well, I don't believe in reincarnation. I say, I do. I believe that Jesus Christ is being made flesh through me, through you. We are his body. And don't get real theological about that, okay? I'm teaching. I'm trying to break open some paradigms here. So I'm having coffee with my buddy from Cambodia in America. This is probably 3 years ago. And he had come back from Cambodia because he had got his butt kicked on the mission field just like I did. But I got to read some of his emails as he was taking an exploratory trip to go back. And he was asking God, you know, Lord, I still feel like we're supposed to be in Cambodia, but I don't know about this because it didn't go so well. We had to come off the field. He came off the field because he started to go into unreached areas. And he started experiencing significant health challenges. He began experiencing nightmares and panic attacks in his family, you know, things just didn't go well. He was okay as long as he stayed in kind of that one area that the Christians had been there for a while. Then he moved out into an unreached area, and it's just, he started tangling with principalities that for 6,000 years had never been challenged on planet Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And so I said, come on up to Madison. He came up to Madison. We began teaching him who he was in Christ. We laid hands on him, some of the stuff that he was carrying, everything that was left, blasted off of him. And he's going back. He's like, I'm pumped. I'm ready. Okay. But he said, I still don't have this work. I know who I am. I can do the good defense for a while. But he said, will you come, you know, and help us get this activated, you know, more. And I was still kind of young in this myself at that time. I said, I will eventually. I know the Lord wants me to go, but when I come, I'm going to come in the fullness of the measure of the blessing of Christ. That's what Paul said. And so I just had the sense that that's what I want to do. And God opened up the doors and we went. And one of the things that provoked me to go is that he shared a testimony. He said there was one village in particular that one of the people that came to live with him, actually both of them that came to live with him, that was their home village. And whenever he would go out there, he would just have this oppression come over him. And he said even other missionaries that he wouldn't tell anything about it. He just said, you know, oh yeah, I'd like to go. And he'd say, okay, he'd make arrangement, and they would go. And he'd come back and he'd say, so how was it? Some of them said, I got there, I had all these questions I was going to ask because they wanted to do cultural research, you know, what's life like in the village, you want to, you know, that kind of stuff. I had all these questions I wanted to ask. I couldn't remember a single word of Khmer, which is the Cambodian language. I literally could not speak, you know, that kind of stuff. I mean, so it was not just, you know, him planting a seed, you know, that there's going to be a lot of thing. I was like, you know, that just infuriates me. There's a principality that needs to be taught a lesson. And so that was really heavy on my heart. So we went over there, and that was the first. We went to 7 villages in 3.5 weeks. The first village we went to, actually the second one, but this is the first one we stayed for any period of time. We went there for 3 days, and that was where we went. And it was so awesome because as we're going in there the first day, I said, listen, it doesn't matter what you feel. It's not about not feeling it. It's about not submitting to it. Okay?
Amen.
When we go there, we are the highest ranking spiritual authority in the village. And so we are going there to take over. We're going there to set captives free. Okay? And this is what we did. It's going to sound really biblical. We went in there and we found out who's sick in the village, right? And then we began ministering. We began healing the sick, casting out demons. We looked for dead people. There weren't any. I didn't see any lepers either in this first village. But people started getting healed. They started getting set free. And it wasn't just me and the mission. Now, the missionary, Dustin, he began to see people get healed. There were Cambodians that we were working with. They were seeing people get healed. So by the time it was lunchtime, everybody on the team had seen somebody get healed.
Amen.
People were getting saved. We went to this one, and so we stopped. And at lunchtime, there was one of the guys that lived with Dustin now had moved back to the village, and his mindset was, I want to reach my village. But he had tried to start all these conversations. You know, people just aren't interested in changing everything they've ever believed and everything their family's ever believed for their entire life. And he's, you know, like a late 20s, early 30s. And in that culture, he's still like in the youth group in their mind, okay? But he's got a wife, and he's got a wife with two kids, and the youngest one is about 8 months old. So she's staying at home taking care of kids while we're wandering around the village laying hands on people. So we get almost getting ready to go back. And you could tell now this is T his name. T said, you know, because he had been healed already of something in his back. He said, oh, I've also got this knee thing. I was like, now you're getting it. See, now when, you know, now it's not just the obvious stuff. You realize that this everything that you're carrying around, Jesus carried that off of you.
Amen.
The same way he carried our sins, he carried our sickness and diseases. That's Amen. What Isaiah 53 teaches. Amen. Uses the same words that he carried our transgressions. Amen. He also carried away our sickness and our disease. That's awesome. It's awesome to know that he did that.
Amen.
So, T got healed, and he said, well, how about my knee? I said, well, we'll take care of that at lunch. And he said, oh, also my wife, ever since the birth of our second child, she's had terrible headaches, neck pain, back pain. And I said, no problem. So we went there, and he said, okay, now pray for my wife. I said, no, you. Right? So he laid hands on her. Her back got healed. Then her neck got healed, and then her headache went away. You know, it took three blasts, right? Boom, boom, boom. But it all left. And he said, okay, what about my knee? And I said, now she's going to pray for your knee. And she got these big old, you know, deer in the headlights eyes at me. Because, and I said, listen, it's not a... She said, no, I didn't go out there. I didn't hear all the stuff you were saying. I said, all the stuff I'm saying isn't really important. This is all you need to know. Jesus is Lord. He wants your husband healed, right? If Jesus were standing here, your husband comes up to him and says, my knee hurts, please heal it. Jesus would say,
healed.
Yes, absolutely, right? So guess what? He is here, and he lives in you. He lives in you. And he's not changed, right? He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. So, and he even said that I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. So, the only thing about Jesus that has changed is his location. Now he's inside of you and inside of me. So, we just need to be willing to let the Holy Spirit, by the Word of God and the power of God, to extract everything in us that has been getting in the way.
Amen.
Can we do that? Can we just say, Holy Spirit, I just surrender. I surrender to that. Remove it all. Get everything out of the way. All my mindsets, all my heart sets. It's just wonderful. Well, this precious lady, I said, all you need to know is that Jesus is going to lay a hand on your husband now. It's going to be your hand. And Jesus is going to speak to that knee, because that's the way Jesus said. He took authority over things. He would say, knee be healed, right? Pain go, knee be healed. So we're going to do it real simple. But he's going to speak through your mouth, through your words. So as you're doing this, as you're stretching out your hand, you believe Jesus is touching. As you speak, you believe Jesus is speaking with his authority, because you speak in his name. He gave you that permission. All right? So put your hand on his knee. In Jesus' name, knee be healed. Pain, go. And I said, okay. Now, T, move it. And he moved it, and he said, still hurts. And she looked at me like, see? Told you it wouldn't work. And all I did, this is all I did, right? This is my impartation, is it's working. Don't worry about it. Do it again. See, that's the thing that we need, is that the Word of God is true.
Yep.
It really works. But we so quickly back down because we believe our experience more than we do the Word of God. But if we will believe the Word of God more than our present tense experience, our experience will begin to come into line with the Word.
Yeah.
But you've got to give God that starting point. You've got to give him that starting point of faith and be willing to say, look, my experience doesn't look like this right now. Okay, great. Who cares? What does Jesus look like?
Amen.
That's the place we put our faith. What does he look like? Because our faith is in the Lord. That's what the Christian faith is. So we're just going to remove stuff. And you know, I don't want anybody getting offended and that kind of thing. Some of this might just be confirmation of stuff you already believe. Some of it might be new for you. But I encourage you, if you come across anything that sounds like, man, I don't think I believe that. That's not what I've been taught my whole life. That's the point where, instead of rising up to say, do like that, that's where I encourage you to say, okay, let's put that on the table and see if Holy Spirit puts it back in or takes it out with the Word. How about that? We just have an openness of heart. And if there's anything that you just say, you know, hey, I don't see it, that's part of the advantage of having, you know, some time together. Tell us on the breaks, raise your hand. We're pretty interactive and that kind of stuff. All I did was tell her, do it again. She did it again. He moved it again. Nope, still the same. Did it again. Move it again. Nope, still the same. Fourth time, though, she hit it again. He moved it again. He said, oh, something changed. That's a lot better. That's a lot better. I said, is it all gone? He said, not all gone, but something just changed. And I said, hit it again. If you can make it move, you can make it leave. And so she did it again, and boom, it was all gone. And she didn't know nothing. Nothing. So it's not about how much you know. It's about who you know.
Amen.
It really is. Do you know, for 17 centuries, most of the church, over 90% of the church, has been functionally illiterate. Literacy, widespread literacy, did not come about until the time of the Reformation almost. And that was still, you know, that was still a smaller segment of the church. Jesus did not make living the Christian life depend on a tremendous amount of theological complexity and that kind of stuff, or even daily Bible reading. You have to get the message of the gospel so that you can get Jesus, the real Jesus, the living Word, to live inside you. But your life is a life of communion, ongoing fellowship, of submitting to the Spirit of God, letting the Spirit of God live his life through you. That's the Christian life. And so, you know, we'll say this probably a kajillion times, but I just want to say the Christian life is supernatural.
Amen.
The whole deal of it is supernatural. Patience is supernatural. Love is, God's love is supernatural. Holiness, we have the Holy Spirit. Do you understand? That's simply God's nature.
Amen.
Holiness is not you striving hard to keep all the rules. The holy, true holiness is just yielding and being filled with the divine nature of God. We have been made partakers of His divine nature, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. That's awesome. Holy is His name. There's none like Him. It means completely other. You can't imitate a completely other. So when we talk about living like Jesus lived and doing what Jesus did, do you understand that Jesus said, I'm not living the life that you're seeing? If you see me, you see who?
Father.
The Father. So Jesus was actually demonstrating to us sonship living, how sons live. Sons don't live apart from the Father. Sons live with their innards in the Father's innards, and the Father's innards in their innards. There's like this invisible umbilical cord. There's a back door to Jesus called the Spirit. And there's a back door to you. And you and I, we screw up because we come into this world trying to fill our souls and get truth and get meaning and significance and everything from this world. We're reaching out here, the front door, and all we do is we bring crap and junk and, you know, more stuff. And we find it just doesn't work.
Amen.
And then we see this altogether different life. We see Jesus. And if you see Him, you see through Him that, wow, where's that life coming from? This supernatural love, this supernatural power that heals, this awesome grace to be able to hang on the cross and say, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And then 3 days later to rise from the dead. Do you understand that life, when you is seated in the heavens in Christ, right?
Yeah.
And when you call on the name of the Lord, a holy umbilical cord, an extension cord, dropped out of heaven and went in your back door here. So now your spirit is filled with His Spirit. Your spirit's made alive. That's what Ephesians chapter 2 says, right? You were dead in your trespasses, and God made you alive together with what? With electricity? Like Frankenstein? No. He made you alive together with what? Christ. He put His Son inside of you. That's the cool thing. That life that raised Jesus from the dead, that life that was put in Mary's womb, that life that hears the Father, right? He said, I dwell in the Father dwells in me. That life that was manifesting every time He said, look, it's my Father doing His works. All I'm doing is what my Father's doing. Do you understand that our humanity was created to contain a different life form? The divine nature of God. And so it's not for us to try to become the source of the Christian life. It's for us to believe, receive, and manifest the Christian life. You understand that? That's what apostolic ministry is really focused on, okay? And I'm not trying to claim any titles for me or Dave or whatever. But in Galatians chapter 4, I just want to point out a few things because I've been in Galatians a lot lately and really like that book. I want to point out just a few things tonight from that book. I think it's important maybe we get in the Word just a second.
Sorry.
Galatians chapter 4:19. Paul says, my children with whom I am again in labor until Christ is formed in you. You understand that he preached a message of the gospel. And apostolic ministry is not just trying to get people out of hell and into heaven. It's preaching the gospel in its fullness so that Christ not only comes into people, but Christ is formed in people. So that when believers are living, they're living by the life of Jesus Christ. So that just the same way that Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father, that anybody could any one of us could say, if you see me, it's not me, it's Jesus. The life I live is not my life, but it's the life of the Son of God living through me. Mm-hmm. Right? That's why he's fighting, because Jesus is not up in heaven obeying the law anymore. Mm-hmm. He's not up there keeping feasts and festivals, or you know, I don't know, maybe he's having bacon, lettuce, tomato sandwiches up there. But he's not. Those were all types and shadows. And here's the thing that I want you to see. Do you understand that Paul rooted them and grounded them in Christ so that Christ was formed in them originally? Then somebody came in afterward with ideas that were not gospel, with ideas that were not the Word. They were from the Bible, but they weren't the Word. Do you understand that? They were biblical ideas, but they were not the Word made flesh. It was not the message of who Jesus was and what he put into us. So people were trying to take people back and to make sons believe that there was something more they had to do before they were ready, before God was ready. I want to show you some awesome stuff here. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 2, Paul says this. He says, the only thing I want to find out from you, did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, are you now perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Listen to this, verse 5. So then, does he who provides you with the Spirit and works miracles among you do it by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Did you hear that?
Is that 5:5?
That's 3:5. Yeah. Galatians 3:5. So listen to this. Paul, I want to make just a few observations. Do you see that that God is providing the Spirit? So we first receive the Spirit in verse 2 because of the message that Paul preached. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. God has totally wiped away your sins. Why? To do what? To adopt you as sons and to put the Spirit of his Son inside of you. Right? Yeah. That was the message. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just you get forgiven, but he takes the sin off of you to put the Spirit of God in you. Mm-hmm. Right? So that you can be a son now. You can live as a son. So you believed and you received the Spirit. They actually received the Spirit. They knew that they had received this. They had an experience of receiving the Holy Spirit. They knew. I didn't get the Holy Spirit when I decided, you know, I was going to stop eating bacon, lettuce, and tomato sandwiches. I didn't get the Holy Spirit when I decided I was going to put tassels on my shirt. I didn't get the Holy Spirit when I decided that I was not going to do any work on Saturday. I got the Holy Spirit when somebody came to me and preached Christ, the good news, that God is not angry with you. He put all his anger on Christ and that he wants to come into you. Amen. The very same life that raised Jesus from the dead. Amen. Believe on him. You'll receive this too. This gift is for you. Yeah. And they believed and they received the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And not only now do they receive, but he's providing the Holy Spirit. There's an ongoing flow of the Holy Spirit. And he's working miracles through them. See, Paul's just saying, hey, you guys know how miracles work. How is God working miracles among you? That's cool. When you have apostles make an important argument of, you understand the Christian life, guys? It doesn't work by you trying to keep the law so that you can attain and be in finally with God. It's that the law has been kept on your behalf perfectly. And all the penalty you deserved was paid for. Amen. And all the righteousness that was required is in Christ. And so now believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and God gives you the relationship of a son. The same relationship that the son has with the father. You get to participate in that now. And that's where you start. That's where you start. Now, don't go and try to be perfected by the flesh. You can't add to that. Mm-hmm. You don't tweak that and you simply believe that the Spirit comes into you, and that's the same thing that allows the Spirit to do miracles through you. Mm-hmm. Same faith. So how many of you have received the Holy Spirit? Okay. All right. Did any of you receive the Holy Spirit when you finally gave up eating bacon? Did any of you receive the Holy Spirit when you finally decided you were going to keep the Passover feasts and festivals and none of that? Okay. Yeah, but only one of the bunch of tribes. No, really, you believed that Jesus purchased for you the Holy Spirit, that it wasn't something you deserved or earned, that you needed that and that you wanted that. And you just say, yes, Lord. Holy Spirit comes in. You know what? You've got enough faith for God to do miracles through you. Yeah. And it's not a different message. It's not like you've got this salvation message that gives you the Spirit, and now you've got this extra thing. You understand? It's not a miracle message. It is the gospel. Paul said that the gospel is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. That's Romans 1, 17 and 18. That's what he preached. So the gospel is a message that has power. God supplies power. It's a message of salvation. Salvation from what? See, we always read that because of the revivalistic influence that happened in the early, in mid-1900s. For a significant period of time, 1800s, 1900s, that was just really trying to get people out of heaven, out of hell and into heaven. So we hear salvation and we think, oh, they got saved. Now they're going to heaven. But when the New Testament uses the word salvation, it's the word sozo. And what it means is delivered, set free, made whole, rescued. So you are rescued, not just from heaven, from hell into heaven. You're rescued from the power and the works of the enemy and brought into the family of God and are provided deliverance from evil. That Jesus Christ comes into you. Well, and we see that, right? He healed the sick. He cast out demons. How many? Everyone that was brought to him.
Amen.
And then he died on the cross for how many? For all. Then he rose again for how many? So who is his victory for? Amen. See, Romans 5 says he rose on our behalf. See, that's 2 Corinthians 5, where it says he died for all and he rose for all, so that those who live would no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Do you understand that he rose on our behalf just the same way he died on our behalf? So when he came out of the grave going, booyah, you know, take that, devil. He did that for every one of us.
Amen.
That victory, he didn't need that for himself. Everything he did for us.
Amen.
He loved us and gave himself for us. Do you understand that he had complete victory as God? But he knew that humanity didn't have victory. So he set aside the exercise of his divinity to live as a human being. Not that he stopped being divine, he just stopped exercising his divine prerogatives so that he could live as a human being, just like you and I, but a complete human being, one who was alive to the Father and the Father alive to him. So he lived as a human being was designed. He was Son of God, Son of Man. So what he was doing, he was not doing as something that you and I couldn't do. We were designed for this. We were built for this. God created us in his image and his likeness. And Jesus is simply redeeming us back into that purpose so that now sin's off of us, devil's out of us, and now Jesus is in us. And so we can now manifest the kingdom of God. We live as sons. He's our prototype, our older brother. So that's an awesome thing. So yeah, when it comes to your spirit, when your spirit's saved, you're born again. When your soul, salvation applied to your soul is deliverance from devils, demonic oppression. And then as salvation, the spirit renews your mind. So it's transformation and deliverance. And then our body, salvation applied to our body is what? Healing and divine health. So God's setting us free. And that's what 1 Thessalonians says, chapter 5, verse 23, that I pray that you might be sanctified, body, soul, and spirit. God loves us. You know, he created our bodies to be, they're good. It's not like these are throwaway things, okay? He created us with good intention. He didn't create our bodies to be a place of torment, torture, pain, sickness, disease. That's the enemy trying to get in. All right, so I hope that's, I'm just kind of trying to lay a bit of a scatter foundation here. But I want to say that this, that one thing that Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father, it's going to be so key. It's so simple. Because it's not about getting a bunch of verses and theology, so, well, here's our theology versus your theology sort of thing. You know, here's, this is what they teach about sickness and disease, and this is what we teach. If it's the word rightly divided, it looks like Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
It
Amen.
Looks like what he did, what he lived, what he taught, what he believed. So if it doesn't look, I mean, you can find Bible verses to support so many things. I was on YouTube the other night, and I found this group of people that believe that Caucasians can't be saved. Honestly, and they were supporting it with Bible verses. It was amazing. It was amazing. Do you know there's a verse in Scripture that says there is no God? Half a verse. There's a group that lives somewhere in America that goes around picketing funerals that says God hates sinners because they got one verse in the Old Testament. You know, but you know, I just say, look, the Word of God rightly divided looks like Jesus. Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father. So let me ask you, how many people does God make sick? Just look at Jesus. You know, he had some real knuckleheads that would not pay attention to him. He never said, well, let me just get a wet oil-soaked 2x4 and whack them over the head with cancer. That'll get their attention. You know, but you have Christians say this every day.
Yeah.
Right? God just needed to get my attention.
Yeah.
He just hit me over the head with a 2x4. Well, I'm sorry. He had some knuckleheads. And he never just said, you know, you are... Doggone it. Cancer for you, buddy. Now that'll teach you to pay attention. Oh, you know, he never did that. And I'm so glad. I'm so glad that my God is Jehovah Rapha.
Amen.
He's God the healer. And that he's manifest perfectly in Jesus. How many people... did Jesus say, you know what, I'd love to heal you, but you got this sin that you forgot to confess 14 years ago, and I keep waiting for you to remember that. And people are just like, I don't know what it is, Jesus, please, please tell me if there's anything wrong with my life, you know. And he didn't do that. But
But how many Christians get backed into a corner of saying, why am I not healed yet? And you got the enemy just suggesting so much stuff. Well, it's there somewhere. Better look. And Jesus just wasn't like that. He said, if you see me, you see the Father, right?
Amen.
People were brought to him. How many people you think have sin in their life, folks? And they all got healed. Because why? He's a Savior. He's a healer. He's what we need. So, listen. He's what the world still needs.
Amen.
He doesn't promote sin, right? If sin got him into that, he would say, he'd get him healed, and then he'd say, go sin no more. Right? But we got a lot of people in the church these days saying, you know, in fact, my missionary buddy, Dustin, he came back sick from Cambodia. His church cut him off as a missionary because they said, you must have sin in your life. We don't know, but we just know you have to have sin in your life because of this. So it took him so much. I mean, we shoot our wounded so bad, so much, and it just grieves the Lord's heart. Nobody's waking up in the morning trying to screw everybody else's life up, okay? We have an enemy who's at work, but this weekend, you're going to get some stuff that if you'll take this to heart and you'll take it to the Word, you'll see we made it way complicated. We made the Bible a book of theology instead of a revelation of a man.
Amen.
Who is filled with God, who's come to live inside of us, to reveal to us who we are in Him.
Amen.
Right? And that's what it gets really simple when you just fix your eyes on Jesus, just like the Word says. And if it doesn't look like Jesus, it might be a verse out there. I'm telling you, if it doesn't look like Him, you've misunderstood it. I liken it to a puzzle, you know, that if you look, once you look at the cover, you see, this is what it looks like. You stop jamming those pieces in ways that they don't fit to try to get them up, you know, to make it the way you think it ought to go.
Right.
And that's really what a lot of what you've got going on. It's not that it couldn't be that way. It would be that way if you were God. I'm just glad Jesus is a lot better. And I'll just say, I'm the first one to say, look, there was a point in my life where God began to open this up to me, and I had to say to people that I had spiritual responsibility for, I'm so sorry. I just have come to realize that I've been wrong about some stuff. And I need to let you know that I'm sorry. And as far as I'm concerned, I am here to pray for you until you get well. Mm-hmm. Period. I'm here to pray for your friends, your enemies, your neighbors. You call me anytime, I'm with you. I'm not going to just try to encourage you to get to know God through this bad situation anymore. You know what? The hillsides would have been empty if Jesus was given chicken noodle for the soup for the soul. The reason that the hillsides were so full is because people got carried up there and they ran home.
Amen. Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
You know? Mm-hmm. And we're so busy trying to encourage people in the midst of what to us seems like a hopeless situation. But Jesus never looked out here to get his definition of the situation. He never worked from the situation to, let's see, he always was working from the back door. He was like, man, if you guys could just see what I'm carrying around inside of me. He always was carrying the solution. His eyes were wide open to that. He's like, there's nothing that's impossible for me, right? Because when he says there shall be nothing impossible for you when you believe.
Amen.
All he's doing is saying, when you think like I think, this is how you will feel in every situation. And that's what I'm just saying. Holy Spirit, wreck us. Just remove all the junk. Clean the filters. We want there to be nothing hindering the flow of your Spirit, of love, of power, of soundness of mind, of firm settledness. So we just bless what you're doing. We bless your people.
everyone here. Father, I thank you for the work that you've already done, for the work that you are doing. For those of you that are hearing this, and some of you, sometimes I just sense that there's a couple here that have, that are hearing this, and that as you're hearing it, you're hearing it through the filter of past experience and current situation, and saying, yeah, if that's true, then why am I still, but what about you? And it's, you're taking your current and past experience and canceling out the word in terms of in its effect in you. And what I want to encourage you to do is just put your butt on the other side. Switch your butt around.
Amen.
What I mean is, look at all that happened in the past and look at what's going on now. But look at Jesus.
Amen.
Look at what he did. Look at what he can do.
Amen.
So instead of hearing all I'm saying and going, but look at my current circumstance, I just want to say, let's elevate the word of God over your present and your past. Let's let God make all things new.
Amen.
Let's let him raise people from the dead. You know, I want to say this, and then we're going to have some ministry time or just go wherever the Spirit wants to go with this tonight.
Yeah.
We're often of the mindset that we're like, that people are waiting on God for miracles. Is that not true? I'm reading through my Bible, and I just want to submit something to you. Over and over and over, I see God waiting on men for miracles. He wants to part the Red Sea. Right? And he tells Moses, stop praying, stretch out your hand. Why? What did this have to do with parting gallons and gallons and gajillion gallons of water? You know what? It had to do with how God ordained things. He created men to be rulers on the earth, and he's not taking it back.
Amen.
He will work through us to manifest his will in his kingdom. He's waiting on somebody who will believe, who will lay hands on a sick person. He's waiting on somebody who will believe, who will speak a word of faith and tell mountains to move. So I just want to encourage you, be the man, be the woman. You release heaven through your faith, through your hands, through your word, because heaven has moved inside of you. That's the way the Christian life works.
Amen.
I'm going to ask the last three rows of people to come up here.
We're going to do one thing first.
No, I want to do this first. Come on. It's been on my heart. I about started weeping. I tend to offend people. I don't mean to. I just don't have a lot of people skills. So don't get too mad. We will teach you how to do this. These are my two Holy Ghost families. I bragged at them all over the world. Come on up. Come on up.
We're missing one.
They've already seen her.
One on.
Patty got a lot of these kids filled with the Holy Ghost in the last year or two, and we told them you could do what we could do. Now, have all you guys healed the sick? Everyone, is there anything that you're not afraid of to attack now? Is there any sickness or disease that scares you? No, because you know the truth. You know. Look at that. That's really big. Phoebe, we introduced her, and she says, I can't wait to raise the dead. This is the result. Every one of them that we trained up get the same results we do.
Amen.
That's big for me. I'm just an old cowboy. So, you guys got any testimonies quick before we...
Don't move. I'm going to take your picture. It might be hard to get y'all up there again.
See, we're not bragging on Dave, Patty, or Andy, or anybody else. We're bragging on Jesus.
Yeah.
And every one of them is getting Jesus results. And I kind of pulled them along. I got them hooked up with anything that I found that was working better. I probably made every one of them mad at one time. Because I sometimes I got to get you to ruffle your feathers so you look at it and say, nope, I don't want that no more. It ain't that I don't love you. Do you scold a kid or tell him not to do something because you love him or don't love him? But if you don't say, hey, stop it, something worse is going to happen. So I hope you know my heart.
Can you guys squish together a little bit?
I already am squishing. I can't squish.
Family, get cozy. Come on.
Careful. You need somebody to stretch you so you'll let go of some of your things that aren't really right.
Okay, then I want to get one that's in there, too. You can keep talking, honey.
All right. She's... I think I got it. Let me double check. All right, that's pretty good.
Thank you.
As close as you get with that many people.
Right, right.
Dave asked if we had any testimonies. I just want to say one of the opportunities that I had right after learning, going through what you guys are going through, is start praying for people that you are in your life every day. And I got the opportunity to pray for my next door neighbor. And she had lupus and was prayed for her. And she went back to the doctor a month later, 5 weeks later or so, and all her blood tests came back clear and she was healed.
Amen.
So that was really great. Just right, I mean, that was right in the beginning too. So.
Yeah. Amen.
That was the first one you prayed for.
That was the first big healing. No, we started ministering to each other in our family right away. We're seeing each other healed.
And what position do you hold?
Kurt and I are the state directors for Illinois, for John G. Lake Ministries.
If you know anybody in Illinois, there's your contact.
And then Andy.
And they live in Sturgeon Bay during the summer.
Yeah.
And we have a house up here. Yeah, so that's kind of cool too. So that's part of the reason they made the trek up here, which is awesome.
So Andy's a regional director to the states?
Wisconsin, Minnesota, South and North Dakota. They gave me all the really cold states.
I guess they gave us the whole central time zone, and I tried to get rid of all of them. And then they gave some back that were... We want to get everybody participating.
Amen.
And it's not that we're lording over, but we want to get you activated. And I take this very seriously. I want people to get the job done. I don't want just somebody has a piece of paper hanging on the wall. Because if I call them up, there's somebody's life hanging on a line. Mm-hmm. I don't want to have a funeral.
Amen.
I don't want to have people missing body parts. Cause... So I found the best people around the world and I put them in position. Mm-hmm. And 2/3 of our ministers that hang with us have raised the dead. Andy and me kind of kid around a lot. We got that same kind of sense of humor. I helped get a couple of the other regional directors for other parts of the country, and several of us have raised the dead in the last year.
I keep looking for volunteers, so this joke's gone on long enough.
Jason Bragg, who he stepped down, he got too busy in his family and his business, and he called us. I went down and seen him. He was like 8 hours south of us. He says, Dave, how come I can't raise the dead? I said, careful what you ask for. Next week, they found his friend on the tractor mowing the lawn up against a rock, still running dead. He screamed at the top of his lung. He commanded, the dead guy sits up, and somewhere we got footage of the dead guy and Jason's testimony.
Mm-hmm.
Week after he was there, I said, careful what you ask for, because you won't learn it the way you want to learn it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Be prepared.
You won't get it learning. We didn't want to go raise the dead. People fell dead in front of us and everybody else panicked. And we did what we were taught. We commanded, you come back, you live, not die. You're going to live. You're going to be totally whole. I had a preacher die at our house a couple years ago. We had several we ministered to ministers, and he came back. We baptized people, and everybody got mad because we went right back to doing the Father's business. I made the dead preacher preach the next night. So, well, what would Jesus do? He's healed. He's set free. The devil is trying to stop us from setting people free. I don't play defense. And there's another thing is every person that we baptize, we put them in the water. When they come out, they're like electrified. They're a new person. The first guy laughed for 24 hours. He just got set free. Next lady made a lap in the pool. We've done hundreds of them.
Praise God.
Most times we got to hold them up because they're just getting wrecked. And we're going to show you some techniques like that. The devil can't. God put it in the Bible for a reason. And we don't use it for the right reason. And we'll get into that tomorrow and later. So anybody, since we have everybody up, go ahead.
Can we have you come up first?
Yeah. And, you know, as we're going to have some ministry and stuff like that tomorrow, we start off here at 9:30 in the morning. I think there were a lot of people, just as they were signing up, said that they would be here on Saturday night, Friday night, and then even now with the snow. So tomorrow's probably going to be pretty full, so it'll be good. And then 7 o'clock Sunday evening, we're going to have miracle service. It will be in this hotel, but a different room, a larger room, so there's plenty of opportunity to invite people. So if you know anybody that's sick or needs ministry at all, please go ahead and start inviting them if you haven't already. And then I'll turn back over last.
Steve's going to come up.
Okay, everyone reaches for their wallet and hides it.
Were you gonna say something, Dave?
Yeah, don't sow money for healing. Do not. We're gonna get you healed regardless. Do not sow any money for any healing.
Yeah, this is a love offering, which means not 10%, it's just whatever is in your heart. And if nothing is in your heart, that's fine. There's no judgment, there's no nothing. And so we're just gonna pass this around, and if you feel like you would like to support these people, then do so. But if, you know, if not, don't worry. It's not a big deal. You know, their provision comes from their Father, and they know that. And so they don't come here, you know, hoping, oh, I hope they're going to give tonight, or else we're not going to get home. No, because even if they thought that, I'd give them money. It'd be okay.
Yeah, if you want to make a check.
Yeah.
Make it to Holy Spirit Led Ministries or HSLM.
HSLM.
Yeah, and then we'll take care of everything. And
yeah.
And then also too, there's brochures and stuff on the back table. Please take those. They've got our contact information on them, websites and that kind of stuff. A lot of great resources at both websites.
Yep. And I think they've got some DHT manuals
yep.
back there. It's well worth the buy. Again, I've done a lot of healing ministry, and by far it's the one that breaks it down to make it the easiest. As you've heard. So anyway, I'm just going to pray. And while I do that, you can think. So Father, God, I thank you for being faithful through all the hard times. And I just give you the glory, God. And I just pray for these people's hearts, God, and the people that are coming tomorrow, Lord God. We declare revival. We declare your Spirit to be poured out, Father God, because your Spirit is in us. And so I just thank you, Father God, that God, as we're obeying, Father, it says that you desire obedience over sacrifice, Father God. And so I just thank you that we can go out and obey your word. And even when we fail to obey, you are faithful and gracious, God, to just pick us back up and say, it's okay. It's okay. You're my children. And so I just thank you for that, Father. And I just pray just a special blessing over the Andy's family and David and Patty, just as they drive and as everyone here, Father God. I just thank you for everyone here. Just pray your blessing upon them in Jesus' name. Amen.
So, if anybody needs healing, though, we will pray for
you
tonight.
Any kind of ministry,
pass it down.
Yeah, whatever you need.
Just want fresh touch from the Lord, that's fine,
Who's
too.
Who's got neck problems? Come on up.
Yeah.
My neck started getting poked over here.
Yeah, anybody have any problems with their knees? Yeah.
If anybody else wants to do the ministry, I'll get you activated. So. Anybody that's never healed the sick? Come on. mind. We're here to get you activated. I'll demonstrate. We do some things, and we'll explain more. A lot of you have been around the goofy churches that try to push you down and do all kinds of things. What we do is we recommend you hold their hands. That way you can't push them. And there's a lot of different reasons. It's just safer that way. You can't get accused of doing stupid stuff. Well, you can. You can. You're not hurt. We get out of the belly, out of your innermost being. That's the important stuff. Step one. So the quickest way we can get you trained is to get you loud and bold. Just like you train. Spoiled little kid. Don't do that, Johnny. Don't do that, Johnny. Don't do it, Johnny. You can feel there's a force. That's all we're doing. What's this? Neck, you become whole right now. In the name of Jesus, I speak life to go through you now. What happened?
You're standing in front of
a horse.
How's your neck?
Full of crunches. It's,
keep moving it. Just don't hurt yourself.
Full of arthritis. It's
going to go. Any pain?
It's still there. Lots of crunches.
I didn't ask that.
Okay.
Does it hurt? The reason we have you move it, I don't have a special gift. I don't have a special miracle anointing. I know how to work the working of miracles. And if I can get you to do something, that's when we had the fake hips. We'll show you some videos, fake rods, body part just become whole. When John and Peter went up to pray, they lifted him up. That was the working of miracles. That's how we can get you activated. We don't teach on the gifts. We teach on the fullness. Anybody can do what Jesus did. I'm going to ask you one more time. Crunching, pop, go now in Jesus' name. And it's working. See, just because it is an instant, I don't pull my faith back. I don't say, well, I guess it ain't working. It ain't instant. That's one way of pulling our faith back.
Farmer puts a seed in.
Come on up,
team. He knows the seed's growing. Right?
Go ahead. You guys have all been trained up.
In the Holy Spirit, I speak life.
See, we don't have to tell. The Holy Spirit is the one that did every miracle in history, right? Do you think I have to tell him how to do his job?
Right.
And actually, the less words I use, the less restriction he has to do whatever he wants. Right. When we start, we usually tell him to say in the name of Jesus, power of the Holy Spirit. Life, you're the light of the world, you're the life of the world, Jesus is the light of the world. It just leaves it unlimited. And the devil can't argue with the name of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit in life. Like, well, they know what they're doing, I'm out of here. You got neck trouble? Come on up. What?
Not anymore. But I wasn't quiet.
No, come on up. I want these other people. Here's the eye guy. You got your eyes healed. Come here. Go to it, buddy.
In the name of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, I speak life.
What happened?
I just got hit.
He's not told you. I warned you. He's a little powerhouse. Even that big guy just went boom. What's changing?
I'm getting blurry. But I still can't see.
Come on, blast her again.
In the name of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, I speak life.
Did you sing and dance and get all stirred up and get the anointing? You know, you got to dance for 2 hours and call it down. Yeah. And they all did all that, right?
No, they're looking like, we can dance in the car.
So how you doing?
No pain. Still crunching.
Come on, team. This ain't the Dave show. It's the Jesus show.
The name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Pain.
Go!
So when we get done, all we do is we tell the devil what he has to do. And we tell your body what it has to do, and we don't stop until we get the Jesus results. Now you can go home and 3-day seminar is over. It really is that simple.
be loosed in Jesus' name. Body, line up right now in Jesus' name.
I'm going to make some bold statements, and we'll explain it scripturally. Now, how many days do you suppose I fast? Anybody got any ideas? In my whole life, how many days have I fasted? What?
Zero?
Yeah, zero. So that breaks a lot of traditions. You know why I couldn't fast? I just knew I couldn't. I just couldn't. I didn't want to be disobedient to pastors, but I just couldn't. And then the scripture comes up. John's disciples come and saying, hey, why don't your disciples fast? And what did he say? Wow, Jesus said they won't fast while I'm with them.
Amen.
Well, Jesus has been with me since before I was 2 years old.
Okay.
In the name of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit. Command all arthritis to go right now. In the name of Jesus.
There.
Touch and go.
Go.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, be healed. Be healed in the name of Jesus.
Because I would have to admit to Jesus that he left me. I couldn't do that.
That's crunching.
And he's with me. How can I say, Jesus, I don't want to hear from you so I can hear from you?
Go in the name of Jesus.
It didn't compute.
Leave. Mm-hmm.
I'm not telling you not to fast, just do it for the right reason.
Now,
I was already hearing from you on a day-by-day hour. I was speaking over people, words of knowledge. I didn't even know what they were. I just knew God was talking. What difference, what category is it in?
Mm-hmm.
Who cares? As long as you get the source right. There it is. Take it. Take it all. Take it all, girl.
So one thing I just want to point out that Simeon is not getting loud because loudness is a good way to start learning how to release the spirit. After you get accustomed to, you actually begin to feel and sense and know what it is to release the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
That loudness doesn't have anything to do with it. God's not hard of hearing. Devils don't have eardrums. But that's just a way that you get, what the loudness is this, okay, is that a lot of times when we pray, we are praying so that another person will hear us. And so we're really up in our head. And what the loudness is it's getting you out of your head so that you're releasing.
Yep.
You're in the rivers of living water out of your inmost being. You're releasing that through a word.
I believe God's going to let me demonstrate this. It usually happens this way. She's sensitive to spirit.
Oh, this? I'm sorry.
And it's a good training thing. Now, it says lay hands and believe. Is there any words in that scripture that we think we have to add to the gospel?
No!
Careful as the last year.
All I want you to do is come and just touch my hand.
No, you're
going
to have to come here.
Okay. I'm not going to say anything. I promise. Just right here. What's happening?
I'm moving.
Stay down there.
We were in California 2 years ago. It was a really charismatic, wild bunch. And they had a lot of these traditions of men that we're going to break off in the next couple days. And I'm just me. I'm an old cowboy. And I took the word of God very seriously. I didn't add things to it. The ladies had a broken arm. Broken wrist, and she has a pin in her shoulder. And she says, well, what can you do for me? And I said, well, how do you pray for this? And I'm going to do it again, okay? Just put your hand out like you got a broken wrist. I said, lady, you tell me when you're healed. She goes, pah! I'm healed. What about the pin? I said, lady, can you put your hand on her? Okay, now the power of God's gonna come out of you. The power of God's gonna come out of you. Like that. And you heard a ricochet bullet and the pin was gone. The ladies, oh my God. So all I was doing is declaring what they already had. And I purposely do not pray or do any of the stuff that people tell me. I don't have to get the anointing. I got Jesus.
Amen.
I don't want two dead prophets. I got Jesus. A double portion of a dead prophet that's in the old covenant that we don't even live under.
Oh my goodness.
That's wrong.
There's new stuff now that I saw a video where there was teenagers, youth groups that were going and camping out on dead saints' graves to try to absorb their anointing and stuff like that. Yeah. And that's wicked. That's wrong. That's wrong.
Evil.
And it's deception. And so that whole mindset that we need the spirit that you need, you received through Jesus. Mm-hmm. Now it's like a smartphone. I had so much stuff in here that when I first got it, all I could do was make a phone call and text. But I needed somebody to show me how to activate what I already had.
Amen.
That's all this is there. The fullness of God is in Jesus Christ. Christ is in you. You don't want any spirit that you didn't receive when you received Jesus.
Right.
You understand?
I don't want an impartation from another man. Because you don't probably want what they carry. I'm sorry. Yeah. That's what the book says.
Yeah.
You got to put the Word of God above everything else. Now, the Spirit is tangible. And I think you guys are okay with this a little bit. I don't want you guys to fake anything already. But I can feel power in my hand. Now, I'm not telling you to go by feeling. But you ready? Mm-hmm. Feel from head to toe.
I like breathing deeper. It's like this energy. Just I'm breathing down into here. There's no pain in my neck. There's less crunching, still crunching, but it's really tight in there. And a lot of oxygen. A lot of oxygen.
Did you have trouble breathing before?
No.
Oh.
No, but I'm just like full of
what something. Happened to you then?
Right now, there's many things going on.
Just a lot of heat. You gotta stop waving your hand.
When I started doing this at first, I was going like this when I was talking. And things like that. I didn't do it. Somehow it was always... Because you are a spirit being, whether you know it or not. You just don't know it. And I didn't know how to... I didn't know I was doing it. I always thought it was somebody else. But it's like putting a seed into somebody. It's working. Like Andy was teaching. I put it in and it's worked. Go ahead. She gets a lot of words, sees a lot of visions. And them eyes are going to become whole.
Amen.
That's confirmation. You know, some days I think we should have a comedy routine.
Yeah, someone laughed. You know, just in case this is new for anybody, sometimes, you know, you read about the power of God, but you don't actually see how it operates. And there is a... There, you know, I don't want anybody being freaked out because different people respond to the power of God in different ways.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just need to say, you know, like it's when Jesus healed the demoniac, you know, they asked Jesus to leave, you know, because they saw all of a sudden now this guy is set free. So I just encourage you, if this is new to you and seeing people be touched with God's power, we don't care if people fall down. We don't care if people stand up. What we want is that they're healed, that they're set free. And if they receive the power of God and it knocks them over, that's not our business.
Alright?
Like energy. Yeah! You're not getting this on the audio!
Yeah, you're going out across the nation.
Are you messing with me?
Maybe.
I think she's not supposed to have her glasses.
I wouldn't give her glasses back.
See, but I feel like what is important to say is the fruit, one of the fruits of the Spirit is peace. And so oftentimes when I release the Spirit, I feel the Spirit of the Lord going through me in a form of peace, and you see people's demeanor just change.
Amen.
And that's one of the things where Dad's talking about, not, you know, not necessarily getting needing to be stirred up, because sometimes, like what Dave's talking about, just need to let go of this and experience the peace of the Lord, because it's a peace of the Lord that goes beyond this understanding. And so it's just learning to take God at His word. And let the fruit of that, of His finished work, of that peace be released. And that often releases peace into other people's lives.
And when Simeon says, let go of this, what he simply means is that this gets settled. Okay? And so, you know, we'll be doing some teaching and stuff like that. But really, all you need to know is it's faith in Jesus. And so the teaching is just to keep this from bouncing around and getting in the way and trying to analyze, because there's so many people like, well, why didn't it happen? Or why does it sometimes take longer with them? And they get in this analyzing, and the whole time they're analyzing, that they're not operating in faith, that this is just, you know, creating a bunch of noise up here. So it's getting this settled down so that you understand, so you don't back down, so you're not analyzing, you're not wondering, you're not questioning, you're not thinking about, well, let me go Google search another conference or something like that, or another book to read. I know what the book says. And your mind's settled so you can just stay in faith and just keep hitting and keep hitting and keep hitting until it goes. And then after a while, the devils begin to realize, man, they always win. They never stop. So you have to retrain sometimes yourself, and then you begin to establish a reputation.
I don't know what he's doing. Yeah. Setting you free.
It's good to hear.
Getting it.
We're gonna get that up. Yeah. I don't even care. I don't need to know. We're just gonna blast this. Heavenly Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, the power of the Holy Ghost, I just speak. What? Life to go through him from head to toe. Body, you line up to the word of God, it will be this way and no other. We're really just the switch. I don't have to tell the Holy Ghost how to do his job.
Yeah.
It's like when I lay hands, he lays his hand on me. He's the helper, we're the doers. If we do our part and quit trying to be the helper, then he can do his job, which is, he can do it better than you can anyway. The less we say, the less we think. I don't need an anointing. I have the anointed one that has everything.
Amen.
It can never leave me. It can never forsake me. I don't have to wait. It doesn't come and go. See how I caused trouble as a kid in churches? Because I knew the author. Nope, that ain't the way it works. Nope. It's more like a yes or no switch. Do you have any pain or symptoms? Okay. What do you guys need?
I
had
my wrist.
You what? Well, Heavenly Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I just speak life. Wrist, you become whole. There's you do your job. See, it really isn't important what I say, it's what I believe.
Tension, leave your neck now.
Jesus. You getting pain? Did you have pain?
Get out.
Yeah.
You have pain? Now do something you couldn't do.
It's life again.
Come on. No pain, just stiffness. Yeah.
Okay, now tell that stiffness to go. Okay,
stiffness go.
Be loose right now. Just tell it what you want it to know.
Strength.
See, if I just give you a fish all the time, you're going to look at Dave. Yeah. But if I teach you how to fish, how to heal your own body, You it's unstoppable.
The pain's gone.
The what?
The pain's gone.
Hey, Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah.
This is waiting for more strength, yeah.
Hey, we'll come into agreement with that. With this big strength in the hand, it's going to get stronger. It's going to become whole.
It stops working.
Peace.
And see, I'm not too prideful that if I don't get to work, we take it. Could you imagine if you're a devil and this crew come around and you just keep getting blasted? Like, I'm out of here. I'm going to find somebody easier to pick on. And if I can get this whole town, this whole area doing this, the devil's going to go to a whole other state or another country.
Amen.
Or way the heck out of here. But we got to get a bunch of believers acting like believers. John Lake put it this way: I can act myself into believing quicker than I can believe myself into acting. Most time I have no feeling. There is a feeling sometime, but in the anointing there really is no feeling. And we'll get into that in the next couple of days. We broke every tradition. Personally, I broke every tradition that people said they have to do this to make it work. And then it comes so simple. When you flip a light switch on, do you sit there and pray about it for 2 hours before you just flip it on? Or when you flip it, you just expect the light of living water. See, when I put my hands,
and you're doing the same?
That's why it starts happening before I get there. The Holy Ghost knows your intentions. Mm-hmm. He knows I'm going to, up to the best of my ability, I'm going to get everybody healed, delivered, born again, and full of the Holy Ghost every meeting I have. And I wish it was 100% all the time, but we've had 100% meetings. We went to the prisons and cleaned them out. I'm wanting it to get bigger. But I still want 100% results every time.
Amen.
And as soon as somebody doesn't get healed, I look in the mirror. I don't say, hey, it's your fault. You don't have enough faith. I said, God, what do I need to change so I get 100% tonight? What do I need to change in me? Because your book says I should get Jesus' results. And I can't blame you. And I can't blame the patient. And when you get to that point, treat every person, heal the sick, raise the dead, and cast out devils, always in the same sentence, right? Yeah. See, how much faith does that dead person have? You going to get him to repent? You going to ask him for forgiveness? So I started treating every person like I do a dead person. I know you're not dead, but that way I can't ask you for anything. And I can't ask the Father because the book says I already got it all. Okay, now how do you get it to work? By persistence. People thought I was... I met some people that thought they were the stubbornest person on earth until they met me. You can ask Patty, she's met them. I've had people, bodybuilders, try to pick me up and throw me and carry me out of church. I said, you can't pick me up. I can pick up 400 pounds, they grab me. What do you weigh? I said, more than you can lift. See, I never backed down. I said, now it's my turn. I'll put my finger on it. Firepower. The word ain't important. It's releasing the kingdom. No. It's getting that attitude. I'm a winner. I can beat anything. With Christ, all things are possible. You know, I can do what Jesus could do. I used to call my big scripture, my unlimited. Hey, you can't kill me. I'm dead. You can't kill a dead man. Most of us just ain't quite dead yet. And you don't have to die physically. But you have to die to your will to do His will. How I overcame that, because most of my life I didn't even like me. I was brainwashed into hating me. And the two commandments, love God with all and love your neighbor as yourself. How do you love your neighbor if you don't love you? I knew if I could get him healed, delivered, and born again, that was Jesus kind of love. And in the middle of it, I started to love me more. Still working on that. But I know I've had a miracle every day for over a decade because I put somebody else's need ahead of mine. That's one of the keys. And it's hard. If you don't even talk to people, how do you get them people set free? I had a phobia about getting in front of people. I took F's in school so I didn't have to get in front of people in camera. I didn't do this for the publicity. I mean, I've been doing it about a decade, and it wasn't until last year I wasn't scared to death. My biggest fear was somebody pulling me up in front of the stage, and they did it all the time. Somebody's been brought back from the dead. Somebody's, oh God, you know, I'd about get sick.
No, I don't want this to go away.
I didn't do it for the money.
Go away.
You can't. You really want to make me mad, try to pay me to get you healed. I mean, nope. And I, you know, so I guess I killed all the things that brought most people down ahead of time. I just,
what does the Bible say? Here's that the locust, the stone.
I just know if Jesus was here, you'd all be set free.
It's Holy Spirit, huh?
And I'm trying to get them 100% meetings. How's your wrist now?
He's doing it great.
Okay, now I'm going to warn you. The devil's a liar. And he's going to try to convince you you're not healed. Any symptoms come back, you get right on and say, no, Jesus healed me. No, Jesus healed me.
Where does faith look?
Jesus come upon this woman.
Does it look at your body? What you feel? Looks at the word. Right? So if the word says that by his stripes we were healed, faith says, yeah. So anything that doesn't line up to that, then we say, that needs to move, right? That's what we speak against and say, this has to move. You be removed. That's the prayer of faith. So that's, I mean, our heart towards God is what? Believing that we've received what we've asked for. What have we asked for? We've asked for the kingdom. He said, yeah, it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You've received the kingdom. Okay, so thank you, Father, we've received the kingdom. So we're always ministering, not from the mountain. We're ministering from the kingdom, and we're speaking to things that don't line up to the kingdom and saying, thank you, Father, that I am healed. This is an intruder. This is a lie. This goes. Amen. In Jesus' name. You move.
Amen.
Yeah, and all the pain is gone. I was sitting here with it aching. I don't feel a thing.
When I asked earlier if anybody's in pain.
Yeah, well, I was.
You should pay attention better if this would have happened 2 hours ago.
Yeah.
And I think you get used to it.
I'm not in pain, but I have need an overhaul.
Need an overhaul?
Come on up. We're here to help you guys.
Anything you need. You
totally activated, healed, set free, empowered. I want you to take this back and walk in this fullness.
Yeah. Father, everything you need, complete wholeness.
Yeah.
Right now. We speak life. 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 In Jesus' name.
I receive it.
Body, you line up with the word of God. Name. Everything not of God, you
in
go!
In Jesus' name.
I'll wait till tomorrow.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
You guys are going to be walking, and you're just going to be wowed by the end of this weekend. It ain't getting more. It's just renewing, getting rid of some of that. You guys have been looking for something before you have. That's the biggest thing, is getting people to quit looking for something they've already got.
Break up everything that's not of God. Yeah. Yeah, Jesus.
God's touching you right now. What do you need? What do you need?
Some kind of freedom.
Come here. He's already touching you. He's already touching you. The Spirit of God is just... Sometimes I look at people, they're just glowing. Go for it.
Right now, in Jesus' name, everything binding him,
go! Be free!
In Jesus' name.
I just feel a strong sense of confidence.
Everything not of God, you
very confident. Go! So Lord has called us to be confident. The Lord has called us to walk in the nature of His Son, Jesus. Mm-hmm. And just to declare in every situation, God is the giver of every good gift. His Spirit cannot be defeated.
What do you need? Alone.
Thank you, Jesus, for you provide for all his needs. Thank you, Jesus, for no more fear. Fear of needs not being met. Fear of no provision in the name of Jesus. I break your power in the name of Jesus. And I command him to be free. I set him free in the name of Jesus. Fear, fear, you leave. You leave. You leave. In Jesus' name, you leave his life.
Give her visions and dreams.
Thank you, Jesus.
I prayed for 80-year-old guy,
not
three
just temporarily,
ago,
Father, but for all eternity, Father. You're raising him.
Bad hearing, bad knees, bad hip. Within a couple months, he was running, went back to work full time. A week ago, he had to scoop the snow for all the 60-year-olds in the neighborhood. 83-year-old guy, he acts like he's 40. He's running. We tried to bring him along, and he wouldn't say why, but he had something special to do. Is that the day? 28th. He said, nope, I can go after the 28th. That's what we'll do before that. You're going to see a new freedom you've never had. Quit blaming yourself.
Strange things just start happening. That you're starting to be going to do some crazy stuff.
I guess in the situations
you're
thousand
of these speaking in the end of your life and in Jesus' name. But in Jesus' name, I speak blacks. But soon you're going to realize that it's
life
forming. It's forming out of you. It's because you're
light.
You're a light of the darkness. You're putting darkness back. In Jesus' name. So. Anyway, I just wanted to prophesy that idea. If you bless him, I'm
so glad you're my brother. Just be prepared for anything. You never know how the devil's going to sidetrack you. And I'm going to throw this out there. You know, the first time the disciples didn't get somebody set free, the kid that fell into the water, fell in the fire, acted like that. I believe the disciples, it must not be working. Jesus let them flail around and said it was working. And he got him set free. So don't let the supernatural distract you. Just remind yourself who you are. You have authority over all the works of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you. It's when we back down. You know, there's no armor on our backside. So if I can get you trained not to back down, just keep pushing on through, they're winning.
Wow. I get this feeling.
And when you get it, you'll get a reputation. Pretty soon it'll be quick, short.
Sitting here
and I was really hoping that wouldn't be on camera, so I get enough love letters from people that think I'm crazy. But when I started declaring that, God had already spoke to
life.
Heidi. She was already on it, and I wanted her to know.
I said,
you're going to have a new freedom.
Blessed.
And we're going to give you some tools to win every battle.
Blessed.
I do want to get healed.
I hope you know my heart. I want to get every one of you a winner. I know what's in you. I wish somebody would have showed me this 40 years sooner. I wouldn't have had such... I wouldn't have had such...
My family, I'm kind of the kid who's like...
So we've gone past our officially allotted time, so if anybody needs to start moving towards the house, feel free. But we'll stay here and minister as long as people want to hang out.
I'm the kid. The Holy Spirit, I just say Holy Spirit. Bill.
We don't have anywhere to go.
We usually don't get out of here until midnight, 1 o'clock. Last night we stopped in Milwaukee to a small arm group. The pastor actually asked if he could bring his wife up here, but she was better. I got a better idea. Why don't we just stop at your house? He said, well, can I have other people? So they got a small group together. And she's up running around, she ain't totally healed, but we're going to keep blasting and blasting and blasting. Sometimes some people are so bound up, it's like healing in Jesus. I hate to admit that. We should be able to get them all in the line up to the Word of God. But I know if we don't
light,
that is one of the keys. Like John Lake learned 100 years ago.
Thank you, Jesus, for breakthrough. Thank you, Jesus, for the means to be just a living breakthrough.
We've had a lot of extra teaching. Well, you know, no. Don't change the recipe.
Down through his
blast.
And thank you, Jesus, but for
the it's kind of like I'm a brick mason. In Jesus' name. You can sit to a tap on a brick and it don't look like nothing. And his last tap, all of a sudden, he just break it half. So if you try to hit him really hard, a lot of times he won't break straight. But if you sit there and just tap on him, the Word of God is like a rock, like a hammer.
I'm glad I did.
Amen. Amen.
A devil never found anybody that he couldn't make back down before. And that's what's happened in this country because we've had so many different flows of ministries that's let them win. They think they can win. I'm an old cowboy. The horse ain't going to be tell me that he ain't going to let me ride. I'm going to fight. I've never found a horse I couldn't ride.
Go.
I was trained border collies. That's one of the best in the world. So do you beat that dog? No. I have a confidence
in Jesus' name.
He knows that I'll die to save his life, and he's going to die to save my life. And I had several of them save my life. The wild boars got me down, were going to eat me. And a little 50-pound boar collie jumps the fence like Super Dog. Looked like the seal of the circus. I know the Holy Ghost about him. These 400 or 500-pound razorbacks, I got up over the fence, got my hot shot, come back, and he's looking like, look at that, Dad. All the boars had their nose in the corner. He was so quick, he could bite them and they couldn't bite him. So then I'd poke him in the butt with a hot shot, and they'd turn around, and he'd finally, they all ran on the truck and hid. There! You eat that cowboy attitude. Yeah, we're going to ride this horse. We're going to break this problem. Onward, Christian soldier. I heard that as a kid, and I looked around the church. Wow, there's something wrong with this song because they don't look like soldiers to me. And they're bored out sometime. Like, what are you done about? Well, I see an army in the song, and I look around like defeated people in the pews.
Why do I have to be like this? And everyone's different.
That's crazy. First time we got married, one of these things happened. And we had all kinds of people going to teach us.
I just
us.
Felt like
well,
happiness and love.
And some of these people have been in the ministry, you know, since high school, college. And it was funny because a lady manifested. You ever see that movie Mask?
I don't really know.
Yeah. Where Carrie's face goes like this. This lady started doing this in our bedroom. We took her out so we didn't make a scene. And the two ladies that were with Patty going to show her how to do it. They ran out of the room. Patty grabs this lady. She started speaking like a man.
She's mine. No, she's not.
And she got set free, and this lady came back normal. She spoke prophetic words. I mean, she got the whole package. And her two mentors decided they didn't know as much as they thought they did. But you got to get it so it ain't scary. Because the devil's going to try to find out what kicks your faith breaker.
When did you, like, accept Jesus?
I loved Jesus since I was a little girl.
A lot of times they don't want something to manifest in the
church. Just like this school. Very loving.
They don't have to feel like I'm going back to
I was
like, we did this, and most times there's not rooms we can use. We had a lady come to First Each King we did live 2 years ago in January. It was our hometown, and I've offended a lot of religious people anyway. And this lady starts manifesting.
We got to stay 100 years.
Oh, God, I'm going to hear about this forever. So my wife and another, I'm still talking and teaching. And Patty goes, go get Dave. And this lady, not Dave, I hate Dave. Okay, here we go. Hey, will somebody else continue to teach? We're going to get this thing. I had one guy who was a Baptist pastor.
Now!
Third generation. It was funny because he didn't believe in another thing. I said, okay. And I prayed for it and I touched him. He fell on the floor for a half hour. But he's not out. I'm like super glued to the floor.
Go.
I didn't have enough fun growing up. I said, hey, is this real? He says, I don't know. I said, well, get up. He said, I can't. I said, do you just come up in front of everybody's church and lay on the floor? No. I said, well, get up. I can't. So after about a half hour, he gets up and goes home. He comes back next week. And I was trying to get people activated, so I'd pick some audience to preach next week. It was just miracle service. Then my buddy James had raised the dead. I said, have James pray for you. You know, he thought I had something up my sleeve and I had a t-shirt on. James laughing just gets stuck. After the third week of doing this, he comes back and he's just mad. He says, my demons didn't like Peter and they didn't like Paul and they don't like Dave Lug either. That's a compliment. He was mad. Like, why do you call them your demons? Well, it turned out later he got into a bunch of witchcraft stuff and the Baptist didn't know how to get him set free. And every time he'd get around me, he's stuck to the floor.
That's you bring now. Come out of here. Now.
We actually got him certified, and he went back to his Baptist church and got kicked out of it. His dad's church kicked him out because he got too many hymn people healed the Bible. He
scriptures.
He had the whole pack
of partaking of Jesus and following him.
So that hotel was bad because that was like a 1,500-member Baptist church.
Don't be afraid.
The sick guy is getting everybody healed the party. Now. So I get you'll get a reputation. You know, and I was never wanted.
I don't care.
And I thought when I started getting the sick, young people would want me. Yeah. They wanted me
just like a demoniac. They say he's a hotel.
These are some world known churches on TV.
Those are great scriptures.
They got a couple hundred people healed in one of these world known churches that was known for healing. They were mad because I just told them I know Jesus. But who are you? They had their apostle and prophet. I'm a believer. Who are you? I told you. I know Jesus. I'm a believer. What gives you the right? Jesus. I told you the answer three times.
Yeah, he did.
Well, I didn't have much goop on the old cowboy. Twice they tried to escort me out and they all fell out of the door. And I turned around, went back in and got another 100+ people here before I went home. And they were really mad at me.
I don't like that.
I might on a day three. I've done it before on my other things, and they're the kind that ask God to show up.
Yeah, well, you don't have to.
Come, Holy Spirit. We're so thirsty.
You know how to get people filled up?
Lives in you.
You really want to make them mad.
You just have to say it.
I had a hard time. I still do.
You don't have to. Sometimes when
you're just thirsty, yes. Here, read this with me.
Some people, the way they
why? Because it says if you're born again, you will never thirst. So you got to make up your mind. I'm saying this, so we'll quit saying you're thirsty then. You make up your mind. Are you saved or are you thirsty? Can you have a generational curse? Huh? Well, they get people writing books over our world known ministers saying you gotta break a generational curse. You know how to break a generational curse?
Same race.
My father's in heaven. My father don't have any curse. It makes that whole book. Yep. You want to break every curse in the world? Here, right here. Jesus, come into my heart. Okay, now I'm born again. I'm saved, I'm filled, I'm delivered. He took four of my sins, he bore my sickness, he bore my curses. They're all laid on him. I'm going to write a book on breaking curse. I'm going to put 200 light pages in the middle of it. It's going to open up, and there's going to be this prayer in the middle of it.
Jesus lives in her. He is Lord of her.
Now you know why they get mad at me. Well, wait a minute. Either you believe the Bible or you don't.
I just bless her in Jesus' name.
I didn't say that. But the sad, that's right.
Go! Of the enemy telling her that she doesn't.
And then I own most of them. Thank God I have to pay for them. I've had hundreds of books in my library, but all they're doing is teaching you how to get curses. We need to write books on what you have and the blessings you have. And if you get you so busy doing Jesus stuff, you won't want to do the other stuff. And your confidence looks like pride to some people. I just know who's in me. I know who's behind me. I know who my father is. Well, you're just prideful. I said, no, I showed you that any one of us can do this. I purposely say, you know, I don't have like any place where I can get my team to do it.
And that it's
you didn't say it, hey, look at Dave. Hey, look at the little kid. She can do what I can do. Look at that little kid. She can do what I can do. Well, you're just prideful. What's wrong with you people? I did this for my business. I have a hard time with people in salvation prayer. So I use it as a prayer cloth. We pray over all of them. And here's how to contact us. Hey, you read this with me. You look at our website. Something like that. There was a lady that was actually it's not having a bad day. I was mad at minister teaching some stupid stuff. I couldn't take anymore. I just went for a walk. And I seen this homeless lady take a can back on this bicycle contraption.
I said, can I pray for you? And she tried to get away. And I wouldn't let her. It's in the name of Jesus.
You see, that's all I did. And then I said, will you read this with me? I don't change a whole lot. And she looks up and says, I'm saying I'm going to heaven. I didn't tell you that. I know I'm going to heaven. I know. I was amazed. Like, wow, it really works this good. It's just the gospel. It's just only the. That's the way the gospel is supposed to be preached with power. And I'm here to tell you, every one of you can do the same thing. That's the cool part. That's why I bring up the young people. They look like a little tiger, didn't they?
Yeah.
Better go after it. They got a confidence. Hey, we can beat this thing. Watch it, Frank. Everywhere you can get, but they're making it hard. They want you to fill out all kinds of paperwork. We went Christmas Eve. Pat's sister started giving stuff away, and then they moved us from the downtown Des Moines to the Skywalk. Hundreds of people started showing up. So we moved it, and they gave us the big square with the big Christmas tree. So we had truckloads of stuff, and the guy says, "We can do that." So we usually take it to Goodwill Salvation Army. So why don't you take it to the show bag? They had one with 300 some beds. So we bring a van full of stuff that was left over. And I said, "Hey, can we pray for people while we're there?" Yeah, so we got one of the guys with a big mouth. Just now, miracles are over here. We did. This lady jumped out of a wheelchair and falls on her face. And so we ran over there. In a few minutes, she was healed, delivered, born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, running to the place.
Yeah.
So they knew her because she was raped for dead in a wheelchair. All the way to that place.
Amen.
Everybody we touched that hand got filled with the
Holy Spirit. Fill him up. Fill him up. Fill him up. Fill
him
up. The night crew wanted us to come back, so we did it. 57 people got healed.
Fire of God. It never burns out.
The upper management didn't like
that. Be released.
So that you saw that all the paper.
Fire in him that never burns out.
And I can't go in because I'm like, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. I figured that was more important than somebody off their deathbed than it was.
Thank you, Jesus, that you're raising them up, Father, to be a permanent, permanent victor. In Jesus' name, Father, that you are raising them up.
They still Father,
that is where you are seated in heavenly places. And you have said, come, reign over the earth with me. You are my co-worker. You are my son. You are my brother. And so in Jesus' name, I speak life. I speak victory.
We just have everybody
into the ministry that the Holy Spirit has
given.
Blessing. I speak peace. I speak.
So we are
tracking the life of God, Father, that the life of God and the truth of God would be everything. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we just pray, Father, that you would just. Father, that you would walk in a constant and consistent level of surrenderance and humility to your spirit, Father. To be able to listen,
beg a guy
to hear, to know your words, Father.
And
you would be able
so
to.
I got another pastor to go down there a couple weeks.
Jesus,
we went into the
be able to
state
him in peace and so in peace.
And there was mostly Methodist type ministers.
Jesus,
and one of the guys that normally went with him was
all the way. All the way.
So
all the way.
Black area.
You got permission from behind saying you can do it. You can do it.
We went up
you can do it. I am so proud of you. I am so encouraged.
When I'm oh my God, the guards
so
are going
to
start shooting us.
Yeah.
How you doing? Took their canes away. And we got into three Methodist churches now. We had a whole bunch of Methodist ministers and their leadership speaking in tongues.
That's
fake.
Great things. Great things. Jesus.
Yeah. I'm trying to get him to ordain me so I can go into the Methodist church and say I'm a Methodist.
To bring life to the nation of God. Raising life. Jesus. And raising life.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're building the spirit up right now, Father.
I think the guards are going to tell me not to.
Yes.
I really don't have any clue. I always do it and then they get mad later.
All hindrances?
Yes.
In Jesus' name, you're gone now.
Because if you ask, you give an opportunity to say no.
The mind, you're broken. Truth breaks strong.
Well, we learned some tricks. Andy's a nice guy. He gets along with pastors. I tend to make him really upset.
Sure.
Here's how I do it.
Sure.
Well, whatever you do, don't let me pray for you, okay?
Sure.
I understand what I just said. Whatever you do, do not. Be the hardest case you know how to do. Hey, I'm a minister. Can I pray for you right now? In the name of Jesus, keep life.
It's already done.
That's how we get all the Indians saved, healed, filled, delivered at the.
But the thing
they can't
is
say
that
no.
The devil,
but we have this mindset that they can
hold on,
who in their right mind would not
amen.
Want to be healed?
Yes and amen.
Nobody.
Yes and
so
amen.
You know you're talking to a spirit or false teaching. So the Bible says to set them free first.
Greatness that Jesus walked in, you walked
so you,
in
the power of God's womb hits them. Most of what we've been taught about. When I heard that first, I was like, we can't be that messed up.
Yes, we were.
Curry makes that teaching in the DHC. 98% of the church is the answers that you'd have the Bible.
Thank you.
And we go through this. It is.
You
gotta get the anointing.
Sure.
You gotta
sure.
fast for so many
sure.
days. You gotta
Jesus
get prayed up beforehand.
Sure.
You know, you gotta
now.
Do this, and this.
Sure.
Really, as soon as you do this, and this,
sure.
you're really admitting Jesus
sure.
didn't do a good enough job.
Yeah.
You gotta have Jesus plus an onion oil. You have Jesus plus fasting, Jesus plus praying 2 hours a day. You're getting yourself into works and not even knowing it. I come from the other thing. Jesus did a really good job, and it's because of him.
I want you to
he told me to go do this.
I saw the
so I threw my anointing oil away. I already told you why I didn't fast, and Jesus never left me. Well, he didn't leave me either. I said, well, you got to make up your mind. I'm just telling you what the word says.
It's spirit to spirit fellowship, right?
Now you know why people get upset with me. Well, doesn't it say that? Well, yeah. So what's the problem? Well, I fast all the time. Well, great. I didn't tell you not to. I just told you I couldn't. And if I fasted, I had to admit that Jesus left me. And we'll do a little skit probably tomorrow.
Keep working with me.
The,
keep working with me.
Your relationship should be Jesus like you and your wife.
I'll work with you as well.
Can you imagine if you told your wife
I just feel
to shut up every day for 21 days so you could hear from her?
Some of those names that you thought we'd never
she wouldn't be too happy, would she?
In your
well,
life.
Well, that's the way I looked at it. I'm hearing Jesus. I know he's here.
Go.
Well, I don't want to hear from you, Jesus. I want to fast so I can hear from you.
She's in a discovering how much. You really
yeah, dumb that sounds.
How much you Jesus really are.
That's how my mind works.
All
like
about
but you wouldn't do that with your wife or your girlfriend or a loved one.
You got
shut up so I can hear from you.
And there's a rule where the Holy Spirit works across this land right now. Where people are waiting to learning about
you're actually admitting that the Spirit of God left you. Jesus left you.
And that he needs you to
I see it. I see what's going on.
Just don't get too mad at me. I'm just telling you what
the book
says. Get
it on the computer or where they're getting it.
I'm
a
son.
That's it. That's it. Son of God.
That's
a son.
And then there's this other teaching
you know where they come from? They took us. You know what that scripture is talking about? You know what that scripture is talking about? You're not supposed to ordain somebody to be a minister. And I agree with that. But it's not about healing the sick. Two different subject
matters.
And you know what? I went to holistic conferences and everything else. I have them all lay hands on me. If I get enough Jesus, they all fall out and get healed and set free. Why should I be afraid of a little devil? But if you believe somebody can transfer something, there's a good chance something's going to transfer. I believe something's going to transfer and it's going to go that way.
See, that's the problem is that we've taught a lot about what the enemy can do. And so people believe it. Instead of what God can do. And that's been the problem is that there's been a lot of teaching about spiritual warfare and all this stuff, and then people get come out of there with all this faith in the power of the enemy. And most basic thing about spiritual warfare is that Jesus Christ has defeated the enemy and he's given us all authority over all his power, and nothing by any means can harm us. So you start there and then add some details if you need to.
Jesus said you
got it. No!
Yeah.
that's true. You're never going to come back.
As long as I can remember,
you know, if there's fear, you shouldn't do it. You know, but that's the problem. Over and over, and then Jesus keeps saying, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid." Yeah. We can listen to the Holy Spirit. If He says, you know, don't do it, then you don't do it. But you don't do it because you're afraid. You just do it because the Holy Spirit said no. But otherwise, you just have confidence that you're just going to receive from God. You got to. Holy Spirit, little grid or sieve, you know, and then goes that way. And Jesus was not afraid for people to touch him or whatever, you know. He was, if it was something that was on his mind.